Blake Speed and Kenny Wallace. Row 19 is Brett Bodine and Joe Nemechek. The 20th row, Bobby Hamilton and Ricky Craven. And out back, it's Ted Musgrave and Morgan Shepherd for the 97th Daytona 500. And among those who failed to qualify, some very big names, Ned.
Yeah, it's always sad to see anyone have to go home, especially from a big race like this. But regulars like David Green, who was going to run, is running for Rookie of the Year. Chad Little, Rick Mast, who has been a mainstay in this sport for a long time. Larry Pearson, Mike Wallace, Standridge. It's sad to see them have to go home, but the field will only hold so many.
Phil Barkdahl withdrew, and Joe Nemechek has taken his position. Felix Avetis buying into the field. The manufacturer's breakdown for today's race. The field is comprised of these cars.
22 Fords, 13 Chevrolets, and 7 Pontiacs.
All of them warming up. Take 2 or 3 minutes on pit road before we kick them loose, take a couple of preliminary laps. And we'll be back for the start of the Daytona 500 following these messages. Forty-two cars have rolled off pit road and now are entering that 3,000-foot backstretch where Buddy Baker was referring to earlier. We'll see them 3 wide. I think we'll see them 4 wide as they head under the tiny Lund grandstand. We have 10 in cars, most ever. You're riding in the quality care Ford of Dale Jarrett right now, two-time winner of this race in row two. Now you're back with Jeff Gordon. Remember, he starts in 6th today. Wishing Rick Hendrick well today. Bill Elliott, number 94, starts 8th in the McDonald's Ford. Here's Sterling Marlin in the number 4 car. Sterling will be coming out of the 9th position today. How about Mark Martin in that Valvoline Ford, still seeking the victory here? Right behind him is Ricky Rudd. Ricky Rudd will start 13th. DW, the Econolodge camera, with a guy celebrating his 25th anniversary in this Daytona 500. The RCA car, that's John Andretti, number 98. He's got some moving to do from 32nd position. And there's Ricky Craven out of Newburgh, Maine. Way back in 40th starting position for Rick Hendrick today after he crashed in the 125s in the Budweiser car. And Morgan Shepherd, the Delco Remy Pontiac, on the tail end of the field as they've completed the first preliminary lap. Speed Week winners thus far as we get down to the big one. Andy Hillenburg winning that ARCA race. Jeff Gordon has won the Clash. Dale and Dale in the 125s. Youngster Brian Sockwell winning the Dash on Friday. Al Unser Jr. came through with a victory, and then Randy LaJoy in that big one yesterday.
It was a big race yesterday. A lot of action in it, certainly.
Field once again down on the west end of the Speedway. Let's see if we get a word from Darrell Waltrip, the 89 winner. Darrell, Ken Squire up here at CBS. Can you read us?
Got you loud and clear there, Kenley Dean.
Well, it sounds like you're pretty confident about today, DW.
I've been coming down here a long time, and I've had a lot of good cars. I've won down here, obviously, but today I feel very comfortable in the car, very confident. Team has done a great job, the Western Auto crew has, and I'm just looking forward to this race. I want to have a good race today. I want to have a lot of fun and enjoy this thing and hopefully bring home a win.
Darrell, this is Ned. What's the key to winning this race?
I think handling is the big thing. The guys that can run wide open late in the long green flag runs that doesn't get to push it up off the corners and have to lift, that's the guy that's going to be hard to deal with all day long.
Okay, go get him.
A fan once told the great racing writer Benny Phillips, you want to sense racing, go down to the first row of the grandstands. You'll touch the power and feel the thunder. You'll feel it through your whole body. It's an American sound. So hold on to your start-finish line seat, whether you're in Portland, Maine, or Portland, Oregon, Madison, Wisconsin, or Madison, Mississippi. CBS hopes you'll touch the power, feel the thunder of this, the great American race. Indeed, an American sound. This 39th annual 500. Rolling through preliminary lap, and then we're going to be going. Let's go back to the pits. Get a quick word from Dick Bergren.
I'm with Richard Childress. How about it, Richard? Is today Earnhardt's day, or is it Skinner's day, or whose day is it?
Well, every man out here, every team out here has worked for it all year long to try it for this moment. So I'm sure the best car is going to end up being the winner.
Any team orders between your two drivers?
We've had a couple of talks. We'll just see how it goes.
Okay, Ken?
Over the years in this 500, Chevrolet has won it 9 times, or rather 11 times, 4 9-times. Plymouth on 4 occasions. The Pontiac has won 3 times here, as has Oldsmobile on 3 occasions. Let's go back to the pits. Ralph Shaheen with us this year.
Kevin Hamlin is the crew chief for Mike Skinner. Any final words as he gets set to lead him to the green?
Well, we just told him to have a good day, be careful, and bring us home a good finish. We're pretty satisfied with the Lowe's Home Improvement Warehouse Chevrolet Monte Carlo right now. We're just tickled to death. We've had a good run all week, and we're just hoping for a good finish today.
Mike Joynt?
Yesterday's Grand National 300 decided by the last drop of fuel after a long green flag run. Ken, the teams say 53 to 55 laps under green is the most they can go. And as we've talked all week, that track position coming out of the pits will be all important today. Let's go to Dick Bergren.
Interesting story is developing here. We have a strong wind at Daytona today, and the drivers, as they are circulating the track for the first time or two, are worried about the paper that is blowing out of the grandstands onto the racetrack. They're concerned that paper may clog the grills. We'll keep an eye on that as the race unfolds.
That took Terry Labonte out of the lead here last year. He was leading the 500 and got paper into the air cleaner itself, and it choked off the motor. So it's a very important thing not to get it in the air cleaners and across the nose of the car.
Down out of turn 4, preparing for a start, 39-year-old Mike Skinner out of Susanville, California, brings the field down. 7 drivers have won from the pole. The last time accomplished, 1987. Awesome Bill did it. Pace car ready to drop off. Darrell Waltrip has said, all of our emphasis, everything we do, is dedicated to winning the Daytona 500. Turn 3, first lap, and the rookie, Mike Skinner, is on the point.
Dale Jarrett got a very bad start there. He dropped back. You can see he's not even in the picture as we look at the front cars there. He dropped all the way back to 6th spot. He did not get off the line very well then.
Those Chevrolets up front really got off to a good start. Mike Skinner and Steve Grissom.
Earnhardt poised on the outside, and look at him 3 wide here. Gordon slinging down to the inside as you ride with Dale Jarrett at 190 miles per hour into turn 1.
And Earnhardt has already taken the lead away from his teammate Mike Skinner. Wow, did they go by there in a hurry?
As you could hear, they were talking about whether they could pass or not. You see Jeff Gordon moving into 3rd place, going into turn 3 there. On the outside is Bill Elliott fighting back.
Elliott off to a great start. Rolls that Ford up on the outside. And then they're all sandwiched in. Jeff Gordon's been the one to make the move on the inside to run even now with Bill Elliott, even across for 3rd spot.
And Kenny used the high groove here late in the race on Thursday and came up towards the front. It might be a little while before that groove really comes into play after their tires get heated up, but he's running on the outside there right now and running pretty good, holding off Jeff Gordon.
Earnhardt has now led in 17 of his 19 Daytona 500s. Dale Jarrett coming back into the thick of it.
You see the third place car there, Bill Elliott. He has moved into third spot all week long. He's been one of the class cars in every practice out there. Bill Elliott is really pumped up for this 500 mile event here.
The outside groove seems to be the best one right now, but they seem to be able to get a better run off the turns from that outside groove. But Jeff Gordon still down on the inside trying to make it work. Now he finds him a hole there and moves up into that outside groove.
200 laps for $4 million. And Richard Childress now has his cars deployed, first and second. Earnhardt and Skinner, one and two. Now Ernie Irvin trying to draft on the inside, pulling up with Grissom. Doesn't work.
There's four cars out in front are in single file. That's the best scenario as far as drafting is concerned.
Well, Ned, you know, in practice here, when they got nose to tail like they are, the first four cars there, and these guys are all backed up, they're running side by side. You really are not as aerodynamic as the cars following each other. Right now, they're losing a little bit of ground to that lead bunch. You can see it's about a five-car length separation there. And if they don't sort this out pretty soon, the first four cars will move away from it.
Further back in this warpath, Jarrett's in fifth, Schrader's in sixth, Grissom in seventh, Mark Martin in eighth, Ernie Irvin in ninth. Rather, that Sterling Marlin up there pulling into eighth, and Martin dropping back on the top. He's in the 10th spot. Michael Waltrip looks like he's 11th, and Robbie Gordon in 12th. You're riding with Sterling Marlin in the number four. That's the eighth position. Off his rear bumper, here comes Robbie Gordon, charging to the inside. Robbie Gordon from 20th to 9th, going for 8th. Two-time winner in IndyCars, Robbie Gordon right down on the inside and trying to move through on Sterling Marlin for 8th position.
Robbie had a fast car in winter testing here during January, had a good qualifying run, now showing what he can do in the big one. Looks like he wants to make a move on his partner up there, Earnhardt.
You know what it looked like to me a little bit? It's the 31 car, Mike Skinner, might be developing a little aero push. They've had a problem with that. A lot of the front-running cars here, when they start into the corner, the front end of the car starts to skate across the surface, and they're not able to hold it right on the bottom of the racetrack.
The number 41 of Steve Grissom has slipped back into 12th position. For more on Skinner, let's go to Mike Shaheen, Ralph Shaheen.
Ken, I've checked on the aero push. No problem, says crew chief Ken Hamlin. He said the only thing they have heard from Mike is regarding the temperatures of the car. They're fine. They're happy to run right behind their teammate. Mike Joy.
Ernie Elliott Thursday night at the engine shop at Dawsonville, Georgia, found something in the intake manifold that has given them 10 to 12 extra horsepower. Elliott was a bullet in the last practice yesterday, and Ernie, after a lot of sleepless nights, stands atop the team's hauler watching today's race.
Boy, 12 horsepower is a lot to pick up. In fact, they normally think in terms of 8 horsepower will give you 1 mile an hour, so that's a mile and a half an hour, and that is significant.
4 1/10 seconds separate first to 42nd position as they work lap 8.
You can see Skinner there. We have the advantage over the pit area there. We can see the race cars all the way around the racetrack. You can see Mike Skinner's car move up as he started on turn 2 there. He was not right on Earnhardt's bumper then. It moved up about a lane coming off the corner.
10 cars in the lead draft about to move away from the field as they run in single file. Jimmy Spencer has moved up to 11th.
Hey guys, does that look like there's some paper on the front of Earnhardt's car on that number 3? Take a look as he comes by here.
Yes, it does. Yes, it does. Absolutely. You can see it down there. How much air that's shutting off from his engine. I don't believe that's going to affect it that much, buddy, down on that area. If it was up on that opening up above there, that might be more of a problem for it.
Well, one thing he'll do, Dale Earnhardt watches the gauges very closely. So if it is a problem,
oh, there's trouble.
Oh, what
car? Control all the way up and over is the number 29.
Robert Presley.
Around goes Presley, and he picks it up.
I don't think I've ever seen a car go up in the air, completely turn over, and land back on the wheels and never touch any part of the sheet metal of that car.
Wow. That had to be a
Robert Presley in an Oh My Heart ride. Boy, you got to see that one again.
He's got a little bit of damage on the nose of the car there. That might have been just coming back down, though.
Tell you, the way it settled down so hard, though, reminds me of Bill Elliott at Talladega. But he looks like he's going to clamber out all right.
That's Elliott. Always nice to see.
Robert Presley is out after the ride of his life. Let's take a look at what happened to this Asheville, North Carolina racer. Gets turned right in here.
Several cars to Terry Labonte. And he were right close together, and then he came and look how high it goes in the air, makes a spin, sits back down on all four, but rest assured it did a lot of damage to the undercarriage of that race car. Took Scooby-Doo for a ride, didn't he?
I'm telling you.
Another view.
You can see him in trouble here. You see the back come up in the air. It hits right on the nose there, but look when it comes down. Watch the back of the car. That is a severe lick. I guarantee it bent everything under the undercarriage there.
Good thing he landed on the pavement, not on the grass. And he still hit the right seat.
Well, that's a tough break. Robert Presley in a new ride this year.
Had started in 19th position. End of his day. Robert Presley, Earnhardt leading in the early moments of the 97 Daytona 500.
Oh no.
Robert Presley took a ride he won't forget for a long time while battling for 15th position.
Ken, right here is Terry Labonte's car, the current Winston Cup champion. Now, we'll move it forward and watch as he makes a move. There's contact made right there between a couple of cars, Ricky Rudd in the orange car there in front. And then as we're moving on further, we see a couple of cars come out of there, and that's Presley coming out in car number 29. Gets off the racetrack, the car gets on his nose, does one of those spins like those ice skaters do, come back down on his wheels, and does a lot of damage to the undercarriage of that race car. Boy, that was a hard lick when it came back down.
Wow, you can see the roof flap there doing its job once it did land back again there, deployed, and around he goes. In a wreck like that, that's the least you could have happen, but a wreck like that last year, Bill Elliott broke his hip.
Mm-hmm. Anybody want to buy some used trailing arms out there today? There's Terry Labonte in the number five
car. He made a pit stop. Let's go to Dick Burke.
Well, Terry Labonte has been in for a brief pit stop. They pounded the left rear quarter out. It looks like it's going to be just fine aerodynamically and in every other way. Appears to be no mechanical damage, but these guys are really mad. Remember last year they led the most laps in the Daytona 500? Didn't win it. This morning Gary Dehart said, this place owes us one. Meanwhile, Earnhardt's temperature gauge is starting to rise slowly, but it's going the wrong way, guys.
Maybe that little piece of paper up there on front. It'll certainly make them heat up because they don't have a lot of space for air to go into the engine.
Ned, the worst thing is running around here slow. You get less air into the front of the car, so it'll run hotter right now than it would be actually out there running at 200 miles an hour.
Today's overhead shots are courtesy of the Goodyear Blimp, Stars and Stripes, based in Pompano Beach, Florida. At the controls, Captain Jim Maloney from Vienna, Virginia. Let's go to Mike Joy.
Jeff Burton also has a piece of air in his grill, and he told the crew he was going to stop and hope it fell off. Well, if not, maybe he could just wipe it off on the back bumper of another car, Ken.
Well, Earnhardt needs to climb up on the back of Buster Otten, who's taken over in the pace car.
I was just looking at the front of Earnhardt's car. It is now clean. That piece of paper is gone. As you can see right there, that's the black part of the sides there on the front. That's the black tape over there.
Ricky Rudd motioning as they come down to get green as we go back to racing. Restart on lap 13.
Couple of cars making moves down on the inside.
Earnhardt out in front in his 19th attempt to win this Daytona 500. He has said, we've been outrun, outpassed, outgassed. We've been beat on a flat tire. We've had some devastating losses. Today, he is trying to turn it around to win. Seven-time Winston Cup champion, but never this race. It's still early in the going, but Bill Elliott, no doubt about it, he's back big time, running in third in that Red McDonald's car.
You can see Dale Jarrett running side by side with Kenny Schrader right now. That's the worst thing they could be doing, but track position is so important. You fight for everything you get in this race.
Trying to break away up in front, Earnhardt and Skinner go with anybody they can. You see Sterling Marlin there in your picture. He's in seventh. Martin in eighth right behind him. Then Jimmy Spencer is up now into ninth. Ernie Irvin to 10th. Michael Waltrip 11th. Robbie Gordon slipped back to 12th. Here's Dale Jarrett coming down to the inside from sixth spot. Dale Jarrett trying to move on the bottom.
The high side is still, it appears to be the best place to be right now. They get a more momentum coming off the turn. You see Mark Martin up there on the outside of Jarrett.
Even across for sixth place through the tri-oval, 18 degrees here.
This is a little short shoot going toward turn one. You can see what happens to the good cars when they get out of line there. You can see two or three cars go by Dale Jarrett just down that short shoot. Now he pulls back going in the corner.
Mark Martin looking back as they're even across. Jimmy Spencer on the high side. And Jarrett fades another spot. Jimmy Spencer pulling up one. Look at this traffic jam at 190 miles per hour. Off those cars as they ramble around these 31 degree banks, and you watch Ernie Irvin in the number 28 off the bottom side fights with Jimmy Spencer for ninth.
Boy, that was a great shot right there. That tells you how fast these cars are going around almost 200 miles an hour as they enter the corners here. You can see some of the cars that started up front, like Steve Grissom, has moved way back in the pack right now. He may be just riding and getting a lot of experience right now. He may have a better car than it shows on the track.
But the winner in the truck series, the first year that NASCAR ran it with eight wins last year, look at Skinner. And hanging around for years, getting a ride anywhere he could. Paid a lot of dues, stays right up in the thick of it. Here's Rusty Wallace in the two car getting caught in the middle there and fading back some. There's Grissom in the 41.
And he gets a run. Ricky Rudd's car apparently broke loose or something went wrong with it. Look at the 10 car in the middle, the orange car. He's everybody passing him. Something might have happened to Ricky's car, or either he got loose and had to get out of the gas. I don't know. There's Steve Grissom in car number 41, still losing some positions. He's back now to 14th position.
Leaders coming around. This time they're going to put 17 laps on the board. Earnhardt and Skinner still deployed, first and second, and Elliott right there, willing to play a waiting game. Knows when to hold them, that guy in number 94.
Right about now, I would say the tires are getting a little bit worn out, and you're getting lighter on your fuel load, so that aero push that we have watched in practice is beginning to start on some of the cars. And if you have a loose condition, it'll start working right now. So the better cars will start moving towards the front, and the guys that are not set up pretty good will start drifting to the back of the field.
I mentioned Ricky Rudd there a moment ago going backwards. He seems to be up to speed now, okay, for his fans. He just apparently got a little loose coming off of two there and had to back off the gas. And when you do that, with these restrictor plate engines, then you really are going to go backwards for a little bit. But Ricky appears to be running okay now. Let's go to the pits and Mike Joy.
Ned, Jim Long told me that Ricky just plain got shuffled out of the draft. I'm down at Bill Elliott's pit with Mike Beam, the crew chief. The Hendrick team cars are running together. The Yates cars, the Roush cars are together. You're a one-car team. How do you make new friends here and find a drafting partner?
One thing you got to remember, all those drivers are greedy anyway. I don't think there's no teamwork out there. You know, I think that if it comes down to the end, they're going to take care of themselves. So it's one, you know, you're by yourself out there anyway. They might help you, but if they see another car that's a little bit faster, they're going to follow you.
So as Mike says, you're on your own.
Ricky Rutt got shuffled back to 19th position. He's running just in front of Rusty Wallace, who's back in 20th. Kyle Petty running in 21st. Riding with Andretti and looking back at Rudd right now, John Andretti in the 18th position. That RCA car, here's Ricky Rudd trying to come down to the inside for the spot. And Rudd's going to collect one. He goes up to 18th, drop Andretti to 19th.
And you can see him as they come down the backstretch as they fan out, try to get two abreast. Michael Waltrip up on the outside of Ernie Irvin coming off of turn four there is right here he is. He's making that high groove work for him.
Ned, just like in some of the qualifying races, that upper groove after about 16 to 18 laps, they started working real well, and the cars that could run up there, boy, they started making great moves.
Michael Waltrip making that 21. The Rudd Brothers car looked great in the early going. 39, Daytona 500. After 22 laps, 55 miles, big change in the leaderboard. You see Elliott third. Schrader has come up to fourth. And the guy who's dropping back, Jeff Gordon, came onto the tail end of that group. He's in eighth position.
Well, he dropped back a little bit. Now he has picked back up behind that lead group. And Dale Jarrett tries to make a move down on the inside. That might not work for him.
There's Schrader in the 33, third place finisher in the 500 a year ago, and having a great race today.
Look at Michael Waltrip out there trying to get under Jeff Gordon. He is flying around this racetrack. He looks to be good on the high side or bottom side. Now he's working with Dale Jarrett as they come down the front straightaway through the tri-oval.
The number 21, Michael Waltrip, ninth position. And problems, looks like he's got a handling problem on Jeff Gordon. He's been skating up the track some. And that number 24, just in front of him, is Mark Martin. Let's go to Mike Joy.
Ken, it's a story we'll hear all day long. Jeff Gordon got up close behind Bill Elliott and had to crack the throttle. When he did, the car behind, Ken Schrader, saw an opportunity, moved underneath, and the whole rest of the pack went with him. Gordon got clotheslined, hung out to dry, and that's the reason he drifted back. They say there's nothing wrong with the car.
Tell you one that's on the move, that red, yellow, and blue car, number 36. What a run by Derek Cope. He started in 29th. He's up there in 10th. He's being challenged for that spot at the present time by Michael Waltrip in the Citgo, number 21, down beneath him. But Derek Cope, 1990 winner of the 500, having a very good race. Up, they get him out to three wide. Jimmy Spencer.
He don't mind sticking it in there.
No, and he's conservative, they say, these days. Oh, my heart.
You see Ernie Irvin moving up in the 28 car, the black one with the star on it there. He's moving up quite well now. He dropped back right at the first of the race, but he seems to be coming back up to speed now.
13th last time by. Dale Jarrett just in front of him, the defending champion, going for three Daytona 500 victories on this February afternoon, President's Weekend. Hope you're enjoying it here on CBS. Earnhardt and Skinner, the Childress cars, remain first and second. And Elliott, who missed seven races last year after he broke his left femur in that crash at Talladega. I tell you what, though, he's still, for the 10th year, most popular driver in Winston Speedway voting.
Very, very popular. Just a down-to-earth type of an individual. Great race driver. Had sort of an off year as a result of that injury at Talladega, but he's back.
Let's give a call to the fourth place car right here. That's Kenny Schrader with his new team, and Petrie seems to have this car really handling well. I was watching Schrader in the corners. He's right down on the white line through the corners. Awfully good handling race car.
Right behind him, Sterling Marlin, new pit chief for that car. Tim Brewer there. He's got that thing percolating.
Well, Jimmy Spencer went around Mark Martin, took Martin all the way to the wall, but he made the pass. Here comes Michael Waltrip now down on the inside of Spencer as we watch that front group. Here's that second group right in there. They're really dicing it up back there.
Jimmy Spencer trying to break away and go up to the front of the hunt. Jeff Gordon hangs on in that group. Battling for the lead.
And car making a pit stop. That's Wally Dahlenbach. This would be an unscheduled stop. They've only run about 27 laps.
How about Dave Marcus in the number 71? He's back in 30th position. This is his 30th Daytona 500. Just in front of him right now, Joe Nemechek in the number 73. And you see Hutch Strickland, the number 8 up in front of him. There's Dahlin back on pit road. Let's go to Mike Joy.
Can they suspect a misfire on Wally Dahlenbach's car? They've had him rev it up. They look underneath. No spark plug wires missing. Distributors tightened down. They're going to send it back out. They've told him that's all they can do.
One of the three cars from Felix Sabetta's team on pit road. 31 seconds. Lap down now, Wally Dahlenbach. Had that great run a year ago for Bud Moore. This year, Bud Moore, with driver Larry Pearson, failed to qualify for the Daytona 500. Second time that's happened. First time was with Larry Pearson's dad, David Pearson, back in 1972. Well, we may be seeing some team strategy here, buddy, with Earnhardt and Skinner. I think Richard Childress has said, get out there, stay out there, and cool it.
Now I think in the rocking chair is Bill Elliott. He seems to have a race car that's just doing everything he wants it to do. He's sitting there in third spot, coming down the back straightaway. You can see he takes it tire management through the corner. Now he's just riding along there. He has a good car behind him, a good car in front of him. And I imagine right now they're talking about the chassis with the crews, and everybody's kind of setting up what they're going to do when they stop, if there's any adjustments.
Take a look here at Terry Labonte closing in on Ricky Craven, the Hendrick cars. Now that's the that would be 22nd and 23rd position at the present time. Ricky Craven just in front of Terry Labonte. And remember, he's had to come out digging. He got way behind.
Well, of course, Terry Labonte made that pit stop after that accident, had a little bit of sheet metal damage to his Chevrolet.
Went back to 40th.
Well, he's gradually coming back up there. Don't let that bother you too much, because Terry Labonte, sometimes you never see him in a race, and then all of a sudden, towards the end, there he is.
But you saw Wallace in that picture as well. Rusty Wallace back in 24th, and Robbie Gordon, who we saw dicing it up in front a little while ago, back in 25th. Here comes a pass for third spot.
You have Gordon going up on the outside, making it going into fourth place.
Schrader.
Going around Schrader. It looks like the high side is the place to pass.
Schrader had started to make a move on Elliott for third, and he backed up a couple.
And look who has caught that group of cars is Sterling Marlin, two-time Daytona 500 winner. He has come from back in the pack, and now right there you see that yellow number four. There he is. Spencer is moving towards the front, too, trying to take over fifth from Ken Schrader. That's Spencer in the yellow car right down on the inside. We're looking out the yellow car of Sterling Marlin, but
to Dick Berggren.
Well, Richard Childress is standing here in his pit area watching our television broadcast, and you're watching your two cars. Are you orchestrating this from the pits, or are your drivers doing this 1-2 shuffle?
Well, they're just sitting up there trying to stay in line. You know, if you get out of line right now, as you can see, some of the cars that's tried it, you'll go right to the back. So we just want them to sit there and run, you know, run a while. Let's see how the cars are working.
You care which one leads?
Not really. You know, Skinner said a while ago he looked like Bill might be getting tired of leading. I said, you just sit there.
Okay. Mike Joy?
Wally Dahlenbach thinks it's a fuel problem. The engine is starving for gas. Then it'll pick up and run a little bit. Then it won't. He can't get over 5,500 RPM, and that's not enough to run here at Daytona. They've lost two laps already trying to make repairs.
Brad Dahlenbach, fifth a year ago. 186.2 miles per hour the last lap up on those leaders. There you see the front four. It's Earnhardt, Skinner, Bill Elliott, Jeff Gordon, the top four.
Before a car
ride of his life here at Daytona. How about Morgan Shepherd in car number one back there in 38th position? He'll work his way back up through this field. New team for him this year, Ned?
Yeah, driving for the Richard Jackson team. Got a late sponsor. Now they're going to run the full circuit in a Pontiac.
Sterling Marlin's car. Something's amiss here.
Well, he was up there battling for fifth position not long ago. We talked about him, how he'd come up through the field, and now he has dropped back to 17th position.
Yeah.
So I don't know what's going on with Sterling. He moved down to the inside there a little bit ago, and a bunch of cars went by him. Buddy?
Ned, you could see as he was going down the straightaway, he passed two or three cars, so it seems to be running okay down the straightaway. He's losing his time in the corners. Sterling's just off the pace just a little bit right now in the corner.
Got a chain gang running up in front. Those front four are trying to draw away out there at the present time. You can see they're working together. Earnhardt, Skinner, Elliott, Gordon to break the draft. Give themselves some distance, but it is way early in this 200-lap event as they work lap number 38. Now, when are they going to come in? Probably after 50?
I'd say somewhere around 52 to 55, depending. But they did have some caution laps. I'm sure they know down in the pits a lot more than I do. Look
here
at this.
Here comes Gordon down to the bottom, challenging Bill Elliott for third spot.
And he's not going to be able to do it, though.
What that did is let the group behind them really close in. Jimmy Spencer must have gained 10 car lengths on that one lap on Jeff Gordon and them when they got side by side down the back straightaway.
Absolutely amazing when two cars get side by side of how much of a it affects the air and how much of a draft opens up so that you can pick up speed.
Well, it sure doesn't look like there's anything wrong with that 24 car right now. Although here comes Jimmy Spencer to the bottom. Gives him a fight for fourth.
Spencer got a run on him, as Buddy said. He really picked up on him a lot. Here comes Mark Martin on the inside.
Three wide, headed into the back straightaway. Oh, my God.
Jimmy Schrader's got to make a choice who he's going with. He's going to go with Mark Martin. No, he's going with Jimmy Spencer. He said he looked like he's going the fastest by him.
But Michael Waltrip has elected to go with the six with Mark Martin on the bottom. Wow. As they double him up.
This could get scary. Three abreast. Look at Schrader. Boy, you don't mind just sticking it right back on up in there. He was between two of the best in the business, Jeff Gordon and Mark Martin.
Right now, everybody's just jockeying for position. As you see right here, they're three wide down the front straightaway.
Now is when that handling really comes into play, Buddy. They've run almost 100 miles now.
It has, and you look at the 22, Ward Burton. The Pontiac was off a little bit in qualifying, but he's really running well in the race. This car has good downforce, and he's making his way to the front.
Sixth position. There it is, the number 22 going around Schrader. And look at Derek Cope continue to come on. That's sort of a sub-team of Rick Hendrick. Jimmy Spencer to fourth. Jeff Gordon falls to fifth. Ward Burton in sixth. Derek Cope is seventh. Schrader to eighth. Down there working the 41st, 102 and a half miles. By leading that 41st lap, Dale Earnhardt has moved past Cale Yarborough into third place on the all-time Daytona 500 lap leader list. Earnhardt now has led 554. The King Petty still on top at 781. Some guy named Buddy Baker. 644 laps he led in his great career here. Let's go to Ralph Shaheen.
Ken, we've been patiently waiting for an update on Robert Presley, who took that wild ride down the backstretch. The latest word out of the infield care center is that they are performing x-rays on him right now. They will evaluate those and then decide whether or not they need him to go across the street to Halifax, where they will perform a CAT scan if needed.
Long way up in the air to settle a 3,400-pound car down.
Yeah, you mentioned that that was similar to the accident Bill Elliott had.
Oh, look at Spencer.
Ooh, boy, he didn't mind getting in there close, moving on the inside of Bill Elliott. I was just about to talk about Bill Elliott at Talladega. He went up in there and came back down and broke his leg. And I think Robert Presley was higher in there than Bill Elliott was in Talladega.
Shocks and springs don't help those kind of rides. Hey. Look at this up in front. Skinner messing around with his teammate Earnhardt. Or vice versa.
Look at Ward Burton there in the 22 car making it three wide down into turn three, and Kenny Schrader coming with him. Ward Burton is on a march towards the front.
Nah, they're not going to get racing in this 500.
Elliott got a little loose there in the middle. Of course, being in the middle of those fast cars will cause you to do that.
Jeff Gordon takes over in second place. Earnhardt continues up in front. Skinner finds himself in third, and South Boston, Virginia's Ward Burton having a great one. He's in fourth.
You can see how still his hands are in the corner. That's just holding the steering wheel. That's right on the bump there, just feeling the car through the corners. But his hands were pretty stationary through the corner. That means the car is doing what he wants it to do.
Jeff Gordon would like to get up there and lead a lap. There are 5 bonus points awarded to any driver who leads a lap during the race. And then there are 5 bonus points for a driver who leads the most laps. And Dale Earnhardt, of course, working towards that right now.
Here's that RCA car. John Andretti being passed right now by Dale Jarrett. That's a squabble that's going on for 14th position. John Andretti had come from 32nd spot. He's backing up a little here. Now you see Sterling Marlin moving alongside and taking the position away. John gets to dig it, comes right back after it.
Boy, there's a group of cars there that have really been battling back and forth, switching positions, and it's amazing they've been doing all of that and the leaders haven't gotten away from them.
From Dale Jarrett looking back as Jarrett assumes the 13th position, Andretti and Sterling Marlin duking it out. Marlin has that position for the moment in the 14th, Andretti back to 15th. There's Sterling Marlin looking him over as he heads out of turn 4 and down into the tri-oval here at the Daytona International Speedway.
Now, just a little while ago, we were talking about Sterling Marlin off the pace a little bit. He's adjusted his line and started using the greener part of the racetrack, which is the higher side groove, and seems to be back up to speed again.
Great pictures out of Sterling Marlin's car. 3,400-pound race cars looking like laundry floating out in the backyard on an easy day. CBS Sports coverage of the 1997 Daytona 500 continues after this message and a word from your local sponsor. Caution, Derek Cope's car getting collected, but it was not the first. I think Jimmy Spencer got some damage in this one. This has just happened a moment ago. Oh, Jeff Bodine once again, number 7. He got hammered in the 125s by Dale McCart. There's Jimmy Spencer's number 23.
There's damage to the right front on his car.
Nose punched in on Jimmy Spencer's car.
That was the front pack. The top 19 cars were running within about 2 seconds of each other from first to 20th.
Here's what happened.
Well, there's Spencer in fourth place. Michael Waltrip behind him, and Spencer gets into the wall. You can see him hit it there on the outside.
That's exactly what we were talking about, that arrow push off the corner. Spencer tried to turn the car. He went right into the wall, and you see a chain reaction happening behind him.
And behind him, getting on the binders, there's Derek Cope spinning. Collects a car, and at 180 miles an hour, I think he got Bill Elliott, huh? Can't be. No, Elliott's down below him. There's another car down here in the grass.
Well, the other car down in the grass was Jeff Bodine that spun down through there.
The 7 car?
Yeah.
QVC car from Sterling Marlin.
See it happening behind him. And once Spencer got into the wall, everybody started checking up, and then other cars started hitting them. It just happened so quick that you don't have time to get on the brakes as close as those cars are running together.
Watch this on the 23, Sterling Marlin coming in.
Oh,
man. Took out his jack man. He's all right. He's right back in there.
Rusty Wallace is coasting into the pits. Whether he ran out of gas, I don't know. His car had slowed down, but now all the leaders will be coming into the pits. But Rusty Wallace is coming in very, very slow. In fact, I think he's just gone a lap down.
Wayne Jakes was that jackman that got thrown in the air. I'm sure that Jimmy had absolutely no brakes with that front end torn up the way it was. Climbed right back up and got into it here.
Pit stops are going to be very critical because of how tough it is to pass on the racetrack.
Dick Bergren.
Everett is in the pit area right now. They've got two tires on the right side. Going to take two more on the left. Let's go to Ralph Sheheen.
Jack Matt Mike Sears has got Mike Skinner's car up in the air as they will change four tires and take gas. They're happy with this car, Mike Joy.
Everybody here wants four tires and fuel route. You see the Rainbow Warriors at work. They're done quickly. And Jeff Gordon will be the second car off pit road behind Michael Waltrip.
Race on pit road. Saw Ernie Irvin make a big move and got around two or three cars. See if that holds up.
I was just fixing to say he went by the yellow line coming out of the pits, but a car run him out there, so it'll be up to NASCAR.
Somebody left a tire behind down here on pit road. We'll be back in a moment with more from Daytona. It's a new race this season, but the action will be as fast as ever, and CBS Sports will be rocking to Texas, to the new Texas Motor Speedway, for the inaugural Texas 500.
I hear the facilities is unbelievable. The number of people that are going to be there for that inaugural race, it's one I'm looking forward to.
The sport continues to grow by leaps and bounds, and I think this is just another step forward as far as NASCAR is concerned.
Live flag-to-flag coverage of the Interstate Batteries 500, April 6, here on CBS.
It's hard to keep on singing.
CBS Sports presentation of the Daytona 500 is sponsored by Brewery Fresh Budweiser, who reminds you fresh beer tastes better. Ford and your Ford dealer. Have you driven a Ford lately? And by the more than 1,500 AutoZone stores across America. AutoZone.
Back at Daytona. Getting back to a restart in less than a lap. Take a look at this again. Jackman Wayne Jenks. Would you call him, buddy, Lucky Jenks?
He's got to be. I'll tell you one nice thing is he cleared the car when it bumped him and did not get caught on that ragged part of the front end of the car. He is very lucky.
Yeah, he sort of rolled with it. These guys are athletes down in the pits.
Dick Bergren.
Jeff Bodine came into this year's Daytona 500 saying he had the entire package together. Right now, however, the left front wheel, instead of having a couple of degrees of camber, has about a foot. And as Jeff unhooks himself, we ask, what happened?
I wish I knew, Dick. Something happened on the back straightaway and just right ahead of me. I was up on the outside, no place to go. I think I was a 36 car that I hit that came across the track and looked like it knocked the left front tire off. Yeah. KBC Ford was running really good. We were just sitting behind that front group. We came from the back right to the front, and the car was handling great, running good. I was feeling pretty good, even though I got this little cold, but these guys are going to fix the car. We'll get back out there and get as many points as we can. Hate to leave Daytona the first race of the year without as many points as what we could have had, but nothing we do about it now.
Let's go to Ralph Sheheen.
Dick, Mike Skinner was assessed a 15-second penalty in the pits. Apparently, the tire carrier went over the wall just a hair too soon, and that cost him 15 seconds. Now, we also have an update for you on Robert Presley. They are going to take him to the Halifax Medical Center to give him a CAT scan on his pelvic area.
Hard hit after that wild flight that he took earlier.
And we mentioned that Rusty Wallace was coasting into the pits as the caution was coming out. Apparently, he's gone behind the wall. He's at least three laps down now, so Rusty Wallace, his woes continue here at Daytona.
Ready on a restart with Michael Waltrip first, Ernie Irvin second, Jeff Gordon is showing in thirds. Then it's Mark Martin fourth. You have Jeff Burton fifth. Sterling Marlin is sixth. Kyle Petty is seventh. Elliott eighth. Earnhardt is now ninth. And Skinner is back to 21st as they work on Rusty Wallace's car.
Yeah, I watched him turn in the garage area. That's a bad sign. That's usually a motor problem.
And the green flag waves, and Michael Waltrip in the Wood Brothers Ford takes off.
Going after the 53rd lap.
The Earnhardt on the bottom there trying to get by Bill Elliott. He usually gets a very good start on restarts. Michael Waltrip, what's the value of a good pit stop? He was running like fifth or sixth, and now he's out front in the Daytona 500.
132 and a half of those 500 miles have been completed. Michael Waltrip gets a chance up in front for the Wood Brothers. It's been a while since that's happened here.
Well, he got himself five bonus points. That could be important at the end of the year. They start counting those points right in this very first race.
37 points separated the championship a year ago. The end of the season. Michael Waltrip in front, seeking his first Winston Cup victory. Here's Mike.
No surprise the Wood brothers should have the fastest pit stop under caution for this first round. Leonard Wood and Glenn ran this team for 40 years, and now they sit on this side of the pit wall while the second generation, Len and Eddie, go to work. But to see you guys out first, well, it seems like old times.
Oh, yeah, that all the credit goes to my nephews and the crew. They heading this thing up now, and I'm just sitting back enjoying it.
So is Michael Waltrip. He's up front.
The Wood brothers, honored here in Daytona, placed in their Hall of Fame this past Monday night. Out of Stuart, Virginia, for Walter Owensboro, Kentucky. And you're riding right now with that number six of Mark Martin Ford.
And just behind him, his teammate in the 99 car, is Ward Burton, or Jeff Burton. And he is really, we'll see if the team concept has anything to do with it, because they're nose to tail right now. And like you said, they're counting points right now. If you could lead right now, it'd mean a lot to you.
Fourth and fifth position. And there's a change up in front. Michael Waltrip on the high side, slipping back. Ernie Irvin moves into the lead. He moved Ernie Irvin around on that restart. He came out, but they set him back a couple of cars. That didn't stop him. Here he is, taking Robert Yates, number 28, up to the point. Gordon comes to second, and it's Mark Martin into third.
Michael caught up on the outside. Now they have new tires on right now, and that bottom groove will work good as long as those tires are cool.
I like that. Cool. All right. As we go along with Jeff Gordon, you can see he has a very fast race car today. Not the best in qualifying, but he has raced extremely well in every race he's been in this week.
Determined to win this race for team owner Rick Hendricks. You're working lap number 56. We're at the Daytona International Speedway. It's the kickoff to the Winston Cup season.
Here comes Gordon.
Take a look at that fast lap.
Thought he was going to make a move, but he couldn't quite do it. He tried to. Yeah, those are pretty fast laps, Ken. That's right there with qualifying speeds.
189.4, all registered by Earnhardt, who finds himself still in ninth position after this restart. That's three laps he's been back there.
He got caught in behind a few cars, but he now has moved himself up to seventh position, so he's beginning to ramble a little bit.
Well, they better get with it, because Earnhardt got away from the group that he was running with and has closed into this front pack. He's right on the tail end there. He's using the high groove right now as they start down towards the back straightaway, but he is really running well.
Gordon took the lead.
Tough day for Rusty Wallace. He's with Ralph Shaheen.
Rusty, what happened?
Blew a motor, and that was it. That's all I know. The car was got a real bad push early on, and then it started going away, and we kept getting it better and better, and we were just going to pit in the last time there and get some wedge out of it, get the tire pressure fixed, and then all of a sudden we lost the motor, but it blew all the heck.
This was the motor you took back to Charlotte after qualifying and running so well with it. Should you maybe not have run the extra dyno miles?
No, I don't think that was a problem. The motor was really good. It just got real tight early on. I told Robin on radio, I said, man, the thing's getting tighter and tighter and tighter, and he said, just stay calm. He said, we'll get it adjusted on our first pit stop. And when I got back running by Terry Labonte, myself, and Hamilton, I had got enough air to the front end to keep it turning okay. But then the motor blew and couldn't fix it.
Unfortunately, Rusty Wallace, the frustration continues. Kenny is now 0 for 51 at Daytona and Talladega.
Oh, boy. And his hopes were so high.
Irvin falls from first to sixth and blasting through down to the bottom. You've got Sterling Marlin and Mark Martin all in there fighting their way up through. Mark Martin to second, Sterling Marlin now third.
Well, like we said, everybody right now would like to get up there and get that five bonus points in the bank right now and then settle down to a good hard race. Jeff Gordon has that 5 points, and I know Rick Hendrick back home is going, hey, this is my kid. He's up front. He runs well here every year, and this may be his year. He's run so well in every race here.
A couple of race cam views for you from Gordon looking back at Mark Martin, and Mark Martin in second spot looking up at the leader. Earnhardt has come to fifth. From ninth, Earnhardt up to fifth. Coming up next, Big Ten matchup between Indiana and Michigan. college hoops following the coverage of today's Daytona 500. Staying in front, that number 24, Jeff Gordon, says there's nothing like confidence in believing in your mind you can do something. We believe in our minds we can go to every racetrack and do well, to be a factor, and that's what they are right now. Here's Dick Bergman.
And Ken, following up on that, this morning before the sun broke over the horizon, Ray Evernham, his crew chief, was in the garage shaking his head. He said, we've tried as hard as we can. We do not have the fastest car. Ours is about the 15th fastest car. He told me, he said, I've got a great driver and I've got a great crew. He said, the team can win the race, even if we don't have the fastest car. Confidence, you bet. They've got a ton of it.
Ricky Craven is making an incredible run. Craven pulls up another spot. He's come from way out back, 40th position, and here he is fighting for ninth.
And that's a pretty good car he's going by there. That's Ernie Irvin, and he is really in the draft, and you can see the car is running quite well.
Ricky Craven, who was out back, got a big fan here today, Travis Roy, young man. That's a cracked windshield on Craven's car. Travis Roy, the young oh, they say it's a cracked lens on the camera. Huh.
That cost us, not them.
Started to say Travis Roy, the young hockey player playing for Boston University in his first game. He is a big Craven fan. His dad, Leroy, was one of Ricky Craven's first crew chiefs up in the state of Maine. And he's here today watching and enjoying what he's seeing right now as Craven motors into the top 10. Let's go back to Ralph Shaheen.
Ken, when you get hit by a 34-pound Winston Cup car like this one did, sometimes you have to go to the garage. When you're a jackman like Wayne Jinks, you just go back to work. He doesn't have time to talk to us. He's under the car, working on Jimmy Spencer's machine, trying to get his driver back in the race.
He'll get the black and blue award for this one. Gordon stays first, Martin in second, Marlin in third, Elliott is in fourth, Waltrip right there in fifth, Earnhardt right there in fifth, Michael Waltrip in sixth, Jared in seventh.
Kenny Schrader in eighth. Those eight cars trying to pull away a little bit from a second group of cars. Running in ninth right now is the Ricky Craven car, but he and Ricky Rudd have hooked up in a line now, so they might be gaining on that pack. The other pack had pulled away a little bit, but no longer now. They're right there.
You may hear Larry McReynolds in the background here. We have his line open. See what he's saying to Earnhardt. In that number three line right there in fifth behind Bill Elliott. Bill Elliott carrying very proudly the number of his late nephew, Casey Elliott, number 94. Trying to make it rural here at Daytona.
They're getting a little nervous back here. You can see Bill Elliott kind of looking to the inside of Sterling Marlin. Bill has been just super good since the green flag come out. He's been in the top five all day long. And Sterling Marlin dropped way off the pace before the first pit stop, but he must have had a grand pit stop to bring him back up that far in the running order.
And I'm sure they made some adjustments on that Chevrolet of Sterling.
How many caution laps?
Now he's right up there.
63 laps complete, 157 and a half miles in the books. 342 miles remaining. There's Elliott right up there behind Sterling Marlin. And the Morgan McClure team looks stout for 1997 based on the performance we've seen thus far.
795.
Ralph Shaheen standing by with Jimmy Spencer.
Ken, Jimmy's waiting to climb back inside his race car. What happened on the track?
Well, Goodyear come over and looked, and they found that a valve stem was broken, the right front tire. We had bumped somebody earlier in the race, and just took that long to blow out, you know. It wasn't no fault of Goodyear's by any means. You know, they built a heck of a good tire. Just fortunate that we got too close to somebody, and the Camel car was running strong, though. You know, I mean, the guys built me a heck of a race car, and I can't say enough about all the support I get from the R.J. Reynolds people. Travis and T. Wayne and most of all Donnie and Cecil and all the guys at the shop. They built one heck of a race car, and we'll be back. We didn't win the Daytona 500, but we're trying to do better next week at Rockingham.
Gentlemen, they're working feverishly on this car. They want to get Jimmy back in the race. As you know, it's a very long Winston Cup season, and today is just a season opener.
Dale Jarrett goes to fourth. Yeah. Brother Dale Earnhardt goes to fourth, and Dale Jarrett picks up a couple of spots here. He goes to sixth. Sterling Marlin looking back at Dale Earnhardt.
That car looked like he's looking back at you. It looked like two big eyes there in the front of that headlight door there as he comes toward you. Dale Earnhardt's car is sticking right on the bottom of the racetrack. He almost got under Sterling Marlin just a second ago. What a great car, and you know that Dale Earnhardt is not happy running fourth.
Looking back from the third place car to the fourth place car. Meanwhile, Mike Skinner in the number 31. He has come from 21st up to 11th as he continues to motor on up through the field. And you're looking at Grissom in the number 41. There's the 31 just in front of him, getting around Craven now, or rather getting around the car of Ernie Irvin. In that 11th spot at Skinner up to 10th, almost.
So he has come from pretty far back after that penalty. Moving right along.
We'll take a commercial break and be back with more of the 39th Daytona 500 in a moment. Scare the living daylights out of everyone, is scared to go on TV. He was until Leslie Stahl talked him into getting on TV. 60 Minutes tonight. That's followed by Touched by an Angel and the CBS Sunday night movie, Dave, starring Sigourney Weaver and Kevin Kline. That's all tonight on CBS.
Now they're mixing them up out on the racetrack. See Sterling Marlin going to second, passing Mark Martin. Dale Earnhardt going with him.
Providing today's shots from above, the Goodyear blimp, Stars and Stripes, the 192-foot blimp, averaging 35 miles an hour, usually flying about 1,000 feet above the Daytona Speedway here.
Meanwhile, just a little bit faster here, you see Dale Jarrett going into turn one, side by side with Mark Martin. They are really battling right now for the third spot.
And that might cost them if those front three Chevrolets get hooked up there. Those nine cars up front have sort of pulled away from the other cars back there. But as they start battling here, it'll be interesting to see how it shakes out.
Bill Elliott alongside now. Number 98, John Andretti, coming very slowly on the pit road and headed back into the garage area. He had a good run going. Say he might have broken an axle, but 98, John Andretti, has retired from the event.
That is a great shot. I love to see a real speed shot like that.
John Andretti pulling in. Or pulling out now of the race, or coming back out again. Went in, made a stop, now he is back on pit row. Saw him go all the way back to the garage area. And here he is into his pits. Sounds like he turned it off there too. Gordon comes out leading. He's got Sterling Marlin right with him. Look at Earnhardt back up to third. Right rear tire perhaps on 98. Ralph, can you tell us more on this one?
Again, they thought they broke the axle on the Andretti car. It's really just a flat right rear tire. They're going to change it, get him right back out.
Cost him a couple of laps at least.
Yeah, that's really going to hurt him. He had a good fast race car here.
Overhead camera looking down on the pit work. We're number 98, John Andretti. Back on the racetrack, Gordon, Sterling Marlin, Earnhardt, 1, 2, 3, and just behind them, you've got Mark Martin, Bill Elliott, Dale Jarrett deployed sixth, Schrader in seventh, Michael Waltrip to eighth, Ricky Craven in ninth.
You can see the Ford starting to rumble back there in third and fourth spot right now. You can see Mark Martin taking a high line and Bill Elliott going with him. They really picked up. Bill Elliott was about 10 car lengths back, and he run that bunch down in one lap. I tell you, he's got a very strong race car.
And he saw Bill Elliott coming, knowing that Bill runs that high line very good. Here he comes on the outside of Dale Earnhardt, still making that high line work. So Mark Martin scooted around the last turn, and here comes Bill Elliott now, Dale Jarrett. Try to make that move. Shuffle Earnhardt back. Michael Waltrip right there also.
And right behind Michael Waltrip, Schrader. Trying to bust through. Michael Waltrip and Schrader up around the outside are trying to get there.
You see Earnhardt dropping back just a little bit right now. I don't know what the problem is. Maybe just a ploy in this part of the racetrack, but you can see he's not going quite as well as he was.
Well, I think he just got caught in that shuffle. Those guys found at the outside could work for them, and they get that momentum up there, buddy, and that's what's happening right now. He's caught down on that inside. Maybe his car is a little bit loose, but he's they're losing a lot of positions, that's for sure.
Yeah, he's tumbling back to the standings. Grissom coming up after him in 10th spot. Dick Berggren.
Crew chief Larry McReynolds said he just got shuffled out. Earnhardt's not said anything to his crew about a problem with the car. They think he's just out of line. Let's go to Mike Joy.
Dick, a lot of these drivers now starting to complain about the handling. These tires have some laps on them, and the wind has really kicked up and become a big factor. Ralph?
Mike, apparently there's still a problem with John Andretti. They changed that tire. He went back out, but he's still complaining of a vibration.
So John Andretti back on the track.
Three laps down. Here are the leaders coming at you.
And it's Baker's dozen out there with a shot at that first position. Just about a second apart. And here's the rest of the back there. You see Bobby Labonte coming at you. Like to be up there in front. He's had some great runs recently, but today he's back in 18th. That's the third pack. His brother Terry is up to 19th. Terry's not too happy with that car number five.
As that group comes off of turn four, the lead group is going into turn one.
Kenny Wallace is back there in the 20th spot. Nemechek, 21st. Greg Sachs, 22nd. Back with those leaders. Jeff Gordon doing what he likes to do best. Stay out in front. Headed towards 80 laps. Jeff Gordon trying for that 20th victory. Back when he was 22 years old, he came here to Daytona and won the Busch Clash. Went on to win the Winston Cup Championship. Watching Jeff Gordon at work. Staying green, we've only had one caution to date. So those tires are getting a little scrubbed off. Sterling Marlin right there in second position, closing down, buddy.
Well, that's what the draft does. Now, he'll drop back just a little bit in the corners. You can see Jeff get about another car length on him. Then Sterling will draft back up down the straightaway and make it very close as they start into the corner.
Looking at the standings here, I'll tell you, when this guy came down here in 93 and won a 125-mile qualifier, this guy, Jeff Gordon, he was then 21 years of age. And he was marked for greatness.
You know, Ray Evernham said this wasn't the fastest car in Daytona, but I'll tell you one thing, he's not giving up the lead very easily. He's led quite a few laps now, and that car seems to be extra strong as Michael Waltrip pulls out and takes a look to take a position on back in the field.
Yeah, Michael Waltrip getting down in there, and Earnhardt has slipped back a couple more spots.
Well, he just picked up a couple on that last lap. He moved around to Michael Waltrip and the 33 car of Ken Schrader.
Indeed, you're right. There he is, right up behind Dale Jarrett another time. Schrader moving back to 11th spot.
All looking at each other, see where do they have weak spots.
Here's that high groove that we talked about earlier in the race. You can see the Fords run very well on the high side of the racetrack, and there goes Dale Jarrett, or Dale Earnhardt, along with him now. That's a two-strong race car going down that back straightaway.
Yeah, trying to muscle each other a little in there. Jarrett looking back at Earnhardt, pulling around Bill Elliott. Jarrett leaves them for a moment. They run side by side, but not by much, maybe a car length.
Boy, they're just about touching. As they did just there, you could see Bill Elliott and Dale Earnhardt kind of touch a little bit as they come off the corner.
And Dale Jarrett is up to fourth position. Let's take a look at that one. Holy, they are really in tight order out there.
Here you see Earnhardt come right up. Wow, he gives him a push. Well, they throw that.
That's bump. Up close and personal, I tell you that what it is.
Bump drafting?
Bump drafting.
Yeah.
Jeff Gordon leading, but it's a long way from over in this one. The 39th Daytona 500. Back at Daytona, 84 laps have been completed. Just one caution. They've covered 210 miles. Gordon is in front. You're riding with Darrell Waltrip back in 33rd position. The question is, could this be his last 500? The winner in 89. 35 cars still in that lead lap. And Darrell, who had such high hopes today, finds himself on the tail end of the lead lap here as we get toward the halfway mark in the 39th annual 500. Two cautions thus far. I said one, let me correct that. Presley in the first one, and then Spencer and Bodine in the second caution period. Gordon stays in front, but a big switch up in that lead group. Dale Jarrett into third with number 88. Earnhardt fourth, Marlin fifth. And as you look at the fastest laps, Earnhardt has still registered them early in the going at 189.4.
And that might stay there, Ken, because that was early in the race with relative new tires. As Michael Waltrip comes down pit road, you wonder if they got his car full of gas. He was the first one out when they made that pit stop. But Michael Waltrip on pit road now. But as the track gets slicker, they can't run quite as fast as they did early in the race.
Working lap 87 as Michael Waltrip comes in. Here's Mike Joy.
Flat tire, Ken. They believe it's on the right side of the car, but Michael Waltrip cut down a tire and has to make this unscheduled stop.
Oh, what a tough break. Oh. He'll lose a lap. He's getting out the... Uh-oh. Had to stop again. Oh, that's going to be costly. Now the engine's died. The leader's coming down. They're going to put a lap on him.
He revved it up there, and it might have shot the clutch out of it. Something happened to the drivetrain.
Mike?
You're right, buddy. He thinks he pulled the transmission out of it when he tried to get going there. They think they've lost the gearbox.
Being rolled back, Michael Waltrip, heartbreaker for the Wood brothers. Running well, back with the race, back straight away. Gordon first, Mark Martin, Jarrett, Earnhardt, and then Bill Elliott. And look at Earnhardt coming.
He got him a good run off turn two from the high side, but he was too far behind to get up on the inside of the other Dale.
Ernie Irvin is in six. Looking a little further back of the field, you have Sterling Marlin seventh, Grissom up to eighth. Here comes Earnhardt chasing Dale Jarrett again. Dale and Dale at it another time.
If Dale Earnhardt waits to the straightaway to pass Dale Jarrett, he's going to be sadly mistaken. You see him now as they started.
Oh, there you see Schrader in trouble and Grissom. Turn three. Grissom in the number 41 outside of the front row. And Kenny Schrader's number 33, both off the track. Caution is out. Third one of the afternoon. Third caution.
41 is Steve Grissom, the outside pole setter. The car number 33 was Ken Schrader.
So, break for some of those guys having handling problems to get on pit road here. See if they can get those things straightened out. The battle for eighth was the 41 and the 33. And on lap 90, it developed into a caution period. Ah, there's Schrader out of the car. His new ride. Andy Petrie, the crew chief, had that thing really ticking. But he comes up short in the Daytona 500 another time for Schrader. So for Steve, there's his crew. Disbelief there as they were looking on to get a look, and we'll give you a look right now as to what happened.
A lot of close racing back in the back of the pack. See Mike Skinner pull out behind Schrader, the green car, and there's Grissom, the white car, right in front. And they all go to all the way to the inside, Schrader and Grissom, and they touch down there and then shoot back across the racetrack, almost getting the car number 31 of Skinner as it came back. Both of them hitting the outside wall, spinning around. You see Ricky Rudd in their orange car coming up behind them there, and Jeff Burton also. They slow down and get on by.
Don't like the way that Grissom slapped that wall, driver's side. Look again here.
It's like Grissom
right there
does not realize the 33's down there, and he pulled down to the inside, and they made contact, and they're along for the ride after they turn around backwards there.
Boy, that looked like Donnie and Cale back in 79. Another look.
Well, here it is. Schrader gets way down on the grass trying to move on the inside of Steve Grissom.
Well, Grissom was low, and Schrader tried to go down there, but once he got the left side tires down in the grass there, it turned him, and you're right. It's the same thing that happened to Cale and Donnie on the back straightaway years back.
Mike Joy on pit road.
Jeff Gordon will get two rounds of wedge in the right rear of the car and four tires. Jeff Burton gets a track bar adjustment. Bill Elliott, fuel and tires only. Dick Berger.
Hoffman Myers is putting two cans of fuel in Dale Earnhardt's car, and he's going to put four tires on it. Just a half a pound of air pressure change in the car, and that's it. To Ralph.
Mike Skinner came in. They put four new tires on the car, filled it up with gas. They see it has a slight air of push, but they're very happy with the way the car is running. They're not even adjusting air pressure.
Field. Getting ready for green once again. Short stop here after two cars get collected. We'll be back in a moment.
Shaft that probably knocked that hanger down that's supposed to do that job, and it did. It kept it from coming out. They're working on it as we speak.
Trying to get him back out here and score some points in this first race of the year. For the Terry Labonte story, back on pit road.
He sure is, Ken. This is the second time he's been back on pit road since everybody else left. Problem, that toe-in problem. Gary Dehart tried to pound the right front fender out to help him aerodynamically. They've got the tires on it straight now, at least as straight as they want to have it, and he's back at him again.
And you see Bobby Hill in 77. They had the hood up and just latched her down again and brought Bobby out. Had a good qualifying run.
He's the last car on the lead lap, Ken, shown in 32nd position. So 32 cars still on the lead lap.
And they're showing Greg Sachs out in front.
Yeah, he got off pit road quick. He evidently just changed
quick.
A couple of tires. Yeah, and he was running fast down pit road, but he got away with it, and we're getting the signal now for one more lap, and we'll go back to racing.
Ah, apparently they didn't have the old meter out checking that one. First time he's led in years. Mid-80s, last time you saw a Sachs run. Let's see how the things go on the pit stops here. Jeff Gordon, 45-9, now back in sixth spot on this restart.
That was because of that lug nut that they had a problem with. You see Mark Martin and Dale Jarrett were identical on their time.
There's Derek Copes, number 36. Had that heart-stopping moment on the back straightaway, and Ralph Shaheen can tell us more.
Well, Ken, I got Steve Grissom and Kenny Schrader here with me. Grissom begged to go first, Kenny. What happened out there with you two?
Kenny just got a good run at me off of two, and, you know, I was just trying to get down to get a push, and he had more on me than... I give him credit for it. I just drove across his front end, and you know, I hate it for the Kodiak team and Kenny's deal. I mean, one of them deals just messed up, and it took us both out.
Sound like a pretty good story?
He's right. We run into each other when we shouldn't have, lap 90 or something. We're out.
Both drivers done for the day, gentlemen.
$4 million. small end of that payoff for those two that were trying so hard. Took it pretty well. Here's Mike Joy.
Ken, out the front of this rear end center section, there's supposed to be the rest of that pinion gear shaft and a drive shaft yoke. You can see it has sheared off. Mike Waltrip standing here with me. What happened?
Well, we cut a tire and had to pit early to get a new tire on the right rear. And when I went to leave the pit, just broke. I've heard of that happening to a lot of the top teams since restrictor plate racing came along, and kind of the weak link, I guess. But the Citgo 4s look good up front. The thing ran really well. Just hate we're out.
Well, they may get them back out there, Ken.
I can add to that. What happens is you race the motor up and you actually let the clutch out before the wheel hits the ground. And when it hits the ground, the motor's already turning up and it snaps everything.
Snap Michael Waltrip right out of the 500. 92 laps complete, 230 miles as they come down to take green after the third caution period of the day.
Rick Sachs leads them all. Mark Martin in second. Dale Jarrett third. Sterling Marlin fourth. Jeff Gordon fifth. Bill Elliott sixth. Jeff Burton seventh. Ernie Irvin eighth. Ricky Craven ninth. And Ricky Rudd tenth.
Skinner back there in 11th spot, followed by Robbie Gordon in 12th and Mayfield 13th. Earnhardt finds himself 14th on this restart. Back to the pits. Update from Ralph Shaheen.
Well, Ken, this is the 29 car of Robert Presley, and sitting inside is a gentleman that finished second yesterday, Todd Bodine. What are you going to do?
I have this ride around a little bit. Robert didn't got a little hurt, a little sore from that deal, and the car really isn't hurt that bad, so let's go out, ride the ride, get some laps for him, and try to pick up a couple spots.
Well, as we told you earlier, they have taken Robert over to Halifax to get a CAT scan on his pelvic area to see how he's doing.
Nice Sunday ride for Todd Bodine. Look at this battle developing up in front.
Mark Martin goes for the lead, and he gets it. That 98 car in front of him there is John Andretti. He's three laps down.
Boy, he set up a good draft, though, for Mark Martin. Mark Martin's actually drafting off Andretti, because you can see he's very quick, and right now Mark Martin's happy he's up there.
Andretti looking back, he's in 33rd position, and he's two laps down on the field.
Almost three. If Mark Martin passes him, he would go three laps down, but technically he is just two laps down since he's in front of the leader.
Mark Martin has it for a moment. Dale Jarrett trying to take it away. Martin has never won the 500. Jarrett on two occasions, 93 and last year, knocking on the door. Dick Bergeron.
Well, on the medical front, Ken, I've just checked in with Dick Trickle's pit, and the word on his nephew, Chris Trickle, is good. They have upgraded his condition to stable. The bullet that was in his head has been removed, and there's all smiles down here. Everybody's very optimistic that this young racer is going to pull through this horrible incident that occurred last week.
We're coming up on a fourth caution. There's that number 90. With Dick Trickle aboard, and we're talking about his nephew in a drive-by shooting out in Las Vegas, and it's been on Trickle's mind. He almost didn't run. He called the family. Yellow is out. They say there's some debris on the track, so that'll bring around the fourth caution of the day.
And get John Andretti one of his laps back.
Yeah, it's going to get him back.
Out on the leader.
That was the point I was going to make, Ned. That's the reason he was running so hard, is any time that you have a car that's fast as the leaders, you can make up one, two, three laps in 500 miles.
And there's the culprit right there, bottom of the racetrack. Back with more at Daytona after this. Pretty good 161 mile per hour average, considering there have been four cautions for 12 laps and six cars have retired from the event. Knocked out most recently, Schrader and Grissom in this backstretch incident. Michael Waltrip is gone. Spencer, Rusty Wallace, and Dahlenbeck. Over at race control, take a look over there. You see Jim Bakhoven, who is in control throughout all the training periods, closest to you.
Mike Helton in the center there. Mm-hmm. And Vice President of Competition for NASCAR.
Gary Nelson down there on the radio right now wearing the dark glasses.
And the guy standing right to the left of Helton with the headset on is David Hoots. He's the guy that sort of calls the shots on race day.
And does a great job. All right, so we're ready to get this one going again. We're bearing down on halfway. Little extra money on halfway. Mark Martin's in front. Dale Jarrett's in second. Sterling Marlin third. And you have Jeff Gordon in fourth. Bill Elliott fifth. Greg Sachs is sixth. Ernie Irvin in seventh. Ricky Craven. And look who's back, Jimmy Spencer, all taped up and ready to go. In ninth is Burton, 10th is Ricky Rudd, and Earnhardt finds himself in 16th on this restart, Ned.
Yeah, he had a slower pit stop. Evidently, they made some adjustments on his Chevrolet during that last caution when he was in the pits and got out. That's uncharacteristic because most of the time, he's the one that's beating others out of the pits.
Derek Cope's car being pushed back, rolled behind the wall after it had a good run early. And we're back under green.
Two laps to halfway.
Yep, just two to halfway in the race. And as they take green, it's Mark Martin out in front with a Ford. Let's go to Nick Berger.
Todd Parrott has been down here working with his stopwatch, his calculator, his notebook, and his pen. What's it all tell you about that number 88 car Dale Jarrett's driving?
Right now, it's not too bad. You know, he's been working on each pit stop all day long, and right now he's in pretty good spot, running second, and we've been all the way back to 15th or 16th, so we got a really good race car today. Just hope it stays up front the rest of the day, and maybe we can come out on top again.
And as far as Earnhardt is concerned, his problem was a real slow pit stop, guys. It was 25.77 seconds. The problem, Childress said the lug nuts fell off. The lug nuts that are glued on the right side wheel fell off, and that'll slow it down for sure.
Yes, sir.
Dale Jarrett hugs second spot. But look at Sterling Marlin coming to the inside, trying to take second place away. He's in there, and he's going to bring Jeff Gordon with him. Sterling Marlin's view of first place, Mark Martin. And from Jeff Gordon's viewpoint.
Now, earlier we saw the passing on the high side, but now that they have new tires on, you'll see some passing on the low side. Then after the tires get heated up, that'll change again.
Working inside, outside, trying to find the fast line down the 3,000 foot back straightaway. Mark Martin never has won the 500. Lives down here in Daytona Beach, has an auto museum down here now.
You see all these front. Here comes Earnhardt up through traffic right now. He kind of bottled in there. He cannot make a move until he gets the third lane that he can use right now. You can see he's just stuck in traffic.
Trying to get himself sorted out and make a run back. He started 16th when they went back to green. Earnhardt has pulled up a few. He's up to 11th. He's got Skinner, his teammate, right on the inside in that number 31 car. Ricky Rudd, he in number 10.
That's
making an impression
traffic now.
He's in the 10th spot.
Heavy traffic.
Here's Skinner picking up Rudd in a draft on the bottom of the racetrack. As you ride with Ricky Rudd in that number 10. Remember back in the early 80s, that awful ride he took for Bud Moore in the Busch Clash? Rolled over a dozen times down through this tri-oval area. Didn't bother him, came right back. It did bother him, but he came right back and ran. Tough guy from Chesapeake, Virginia, Ricky Rudd, who's won every year for the past 14 years in Winston Cup racing.
What a streak he has going. This is the cars that are running back from 8th through about 16th.
Rick Sachs, number 20, has fallen back from the lead.
Which leads you to believe, oh boy, look up front here. Wow.
That's Sterling Marlin.
And Dale Jarrett up on the outside of Sterling Marlin as Ernie Irvin comes on the outside of Jeff Gordon.
Ernie Irvin really took advantage of those cars bobbing up back there going into turn three and really moved up into position there.
Mark Martin stays up in front. Now to take a look here at Sterling on the inside.
Well, Sterling's really hung out to dry right there. He has absolutely nobody helping him on that bottom line. You can see him losing ground right here as the Budweiser car goes by on the outside there, and Bill Elliott now goes by himself. Boy, look, you talk about moving back. There goes Jeff Gordon by.
Not a thing in the world Sterling can do about it. He just hopes to get back in line.
Ricky Craven, from a provisional start, now up to fourth in that Budweiser number 25 for Rick Hendrick.
Well, he said before this year started, there's a new kid in town, and I guarantee you Ricky Craven really wants to make amends for making that mistake in the 125s when he got over and he and Chad Little got together and had the wreck. He took all the blame for it, but he's going today.
Yeah, he said, I made the mistake, and he got a lot of points with a lot of folks for being so forward about it. Rob Shaheen?
Ken, troubling day for John Andretti. He had made up one lap, they asked the NASCAR officials if they could pit with the leaders. When the NASCAR officials said, pit now, they went for it. They came down pit road and made their pit stop. Crew chief Tony Fury was fighting with the NASCAR officials because once they made their pit stop, the NASCAR officials said, I'm sorry, pit road was closed. Tony said, but you said we could pit. NASCAR officials said, not good enough of an answer. They were then forced to the back of the longest line. So John Andretti is now two laps down, but had a golden opportunity to only be one lap down.
Now there's a story for you, John Andretti.
Yeah, he could have pulled right back up there and tried to do what he did there before, but
got himself another shot, three wide in here. And that's Rudd pressing the middle with Skinner on the bottom side. And look at Joe Nemechek in the 73 up on the outside. This is back 16th, 17th, 18th.
Nemechek having a great run in a borrowed car or a bought car or whatever the deal was. They made a deal when he didn't make the show in his car. Phil Barkdahl did make the show. So they got together and
take a look at this. Here's Ernie Irvin down to the inside. Craven right there with him, just behind Dale Jarrett in second place as they continue to stomp and storm for the lead. You've got number six, Mark Martin, in his 13th effort to win the 500 out in front. Dale Jarrett's right there in second spot. Even across, Ricky Craven has clawed his way up to the field, and he runs with Ernie Irvin on the inside for that third position. And directly behind them, oh, look at that. Jeff Gordon and Bill Elliott. This is getting good.
Okay, there's two teammates hooked up together with Bill Elliott just behind them. You can see Ernie Irvin's kind of hung out there. He's sliding back through the field.
Mike Joy.
Sterling Marlin was second. He got shuffled back to 10th. He's fought his way back to 7th. Tim Brewer, crew chief, not a happy guy right now. When he went to the bottom, where did all his friends go?
Well, you know, it's time to abandon ship. You know, he's got a pretty strong race car, but still yet everybody out there needs a dancing partner. But they get an opportunity to kind of throw you out.
Mike, Ricky Craven had fallen deep into the field at the beginning stages of this race. He had radioed into his crew that he was having vibrations. They were even concerned the motor might blow. For him to have fought his way back up into the lead pack is amazing today.
And considering that he started 40th, moved up some, then fell all the way back. And here he is knocking on the door. Right up there in second spot behind Mark Martin, who keeps nipping away closer and closer. 95, he was third at the finish. In 96, he was fourth. He's once again dominating this portion of the event. Let's see if anybody's going to take a crack at him here. Ford first, Chevy in second.
Almost the entire field running in the lead draft. Just a few cars that are back out of it.
Let's take a lap from the Goodyear blimp. Follow them around this 2.5 mile track. Three of the drivers right now in this top 10 have never won a race. Craven, Jeff Burton, and Robbie Gordon. Yep, Robbie Gordon, number 40, as you look down that 3,000-foot backstretch. He's in eighth spot in that bundle of cars. Jeff Burton's in the 99 and ninth. Earnhardt's up to 10th. Earnhardt's coming. Goodyear blimps are now in their fourth decade of live sports coverage. First ever event, the Orange Bowl, 1960. It was right here on CBS. Here's the old Stars and Stripes. And the Stars and Stripes right now are flying that red, white, and blue car out in front. Mark Martin has the advantage over Craven. They've rewritten this Daytona 500 in their style.
You see Craven looking around. He moved to the outside and to the inside to see if Gordon was going to go with him. And he looked in the mirror and there wasn't anybody there with him. He fell back in line. But I know Craven would love to be leading this race right now.
Back in the pits with Dick Berggren.
Robbie Gordon would like to be leading this race as well. You were talking about him moving up toward the front. He drives for colorful car owner Felix Sabatis, and as is well known, Felix has some unusual bonuses for his driver. He has told Robbie Gordon if he wins this race, he's going to get an antique Rolls Royce. So guess what Gordon told Felix he's going to do? Cut the back off it, put a pickup truck back on it, put a big motor under the hood, and turn it into a hot rod.
Nice going, Robbie. All right, Mark Martin stays up there, but here comes Craven, and take a look. There's Bodine. Remember, he got bashed a while ago, and he's right back in it. Several laps, many laps down, but he's running fast. What?
Yeah.
45 laps? 40 laps?
45 laps down.
And they're saying there's some smoke coming out of the number 7. They may want to take that one in and take a look at it. As it goes around, Grissom's number 29 with Todd Bodine now driving. Leaders again. Here comes Craven.
See, Craven tried to go to the outside, and Mark Martin leading the race. He took that high line there and cut him off just a little bit. You can do that. Gordon goes high, though.
He goes very high, and he's going to lose three positions. Wow, he almost bought the farm there.
Elliott comes up to third. Jarrett comes into fourth. Urban to fifth. They say it's a flat tire. They say they have a tire going down on number 24. Limping around, Gordon trying to get it onto pit road. Left rear tire on number 24 may be the culprit.
Wow, that is a tough break for Jeff Gordon. Let's see. He comes off the fourth turn and does indeed head for pit road.
111 of 200 laps now complete. Gordon in trouble on pit road.
It'll be very hard not to lose a lap. As pit road speed is 65 miles an hour. Let's go to the pits and Mike Joy.
They're saying it's the right rear tire. No. Andy Papathanasiou gives a thumbs up. He says, no, it's not the right rear. They're going to change both right sides anyway. Gordon was ready to make a run with Ricky Craven when he slid high up the racetrack. They were going for the lead in tandem. Now he may lose a lap.
He might, Mike, because the leaders are coming off of turn four, and it takes a long time to get that speed up with these restricted plate engines, restrictor plates on the carburetors of these engines, and it'll be very difficult for him to stay in the lead lap. He might do it.
The tire was not flat. The car just took off on him. That's what Jeff Gordon said, and they thought it was a left rear. Check the right rear, left rear. Get him back out there, and he's about to be overrun as they come down out of turn two. Martin trying to put a lap on him as they go down the back straightaway. Craven right there with him, and Elliott in third. We'll be back with the outcome of this story in a moment. In command of this race with car number 6, Bill Elliott has come to second. Dale Jarrett is into third, and Ricky Craven has dropped well back all of a sudden. He fell to eighth, and now he's falling further back. He got caught down on the bottom on the inside of the racetrack net.
And they just
there
drafted right past him on the outside. There wasn't a great deal that he could do about it once you get some that team up on him.
Buddy, how do you feel about this race at halfway?
Well, I feel like right now we're seeing the better handling race cars out front. Earnhardt keeps running back up to the front. No matter if he has a bad pit stop or what, he always ends right back up in the front. I think right now he may have the fastest car out there, and he has moved. He dropped to 16th, and he's already back up to 6th.
I'm really impressed with Bill Elliott's run today. That 94 car been bulletproof since the start of this thing little afternoon.
And they're coming up on Jeff Gordon. He made a good pit stop, a good fast pit stop. We said it would be hard not to go a lap down. Well, see, these cars are drafting back behind him, and they're picking up about a half a second a lap on him. There's not anything he can do about it.
What he's got to hope is when Mark Martin gets to him, he's running so much faster with the help of the draft that he goes right by him. If he can stay just in front and catch a caution and come right back up behind the field, but he does not look like he's going to be able to hold him off.
What he wants is a caution desperately right now, but not another moment later. For more on the Gordon story, let's go to Mike Joy.
Jeff Gordon's tire was not flat, but it was cut. There is the imprint made by a piece of debris. He was losing air pressure and wisely made the call to come in. So, Ray Evernham, you can't gamble on a thing like that, even if it costs you a lap.
No, he did an excellent job calling that, too. He had run over something in the right rear and got the right rear tire about spun out. You know, the only thing we can do now is hope to stay on the lead lap until we get a caution and try and make some of this up. But, you know, I don't know. That's part of racing, I guess. You know, believe it or not, Mike, I want to say that's the first tire we've ever cut, you know, had to come in for a cut tire.
Well, it came at a bad time for them.
But he is on the tail end of the lead lap, and he's able to hold that lead right now. If the caution come out, he would move right up behind the lead traffic.
He'd be right back in it.
He eased himself right out of the front of that train.
Yeah, he's got a good fast race car. So he might be able to hold there.
Does that help Martin a little here?
Yeah, I think it does. Actually, I think, according to my watch, they're running a little bit faster now that they caught up to Jeff Gordon than they were when Martin was out there leading by himself. With those two fresh tires on the right side, that's going to help Gordon, plus the fact that he had a fast race car anyway.
If I had those guys behind him, though, I'd want to get Jeff Gordon a lap down. I'd be licking my chops if I got a shot at him. I'd sure put him a lap down.
Well, I agree with you. Totally. I think they're thinking that same way. But maybe there's not a whole lot they can do about it.
Bill Elliott in second place, looking at the leader, Mark Martin, and Jeff Gordon on the tail end of the lead lap. That puts him back in 31st spot. 31 cars past the halfway point, still in the lead lap of this Daytona 500. Now you're with Dale Jarrett. He's in third spot, Ernie Irvin in fourth, Earnhardt in fifth, and Greg Sachs stays up in sixth place.
Greg having a great run today.
With Buddy Baker, Ned Jarrett, Ken Squire topside, Dick Bergren, Ralph Shaheen, Mike Joy, down there covering the pit action of the 39th annual Daytona 500.
Boy, that camera was working great then. Oh, trouble.
Trouble big
time. That is Greg Sachs. We were just talking about it. Oh, man, what a tough break. Oh, bangs it hard into the wall. Both ends of it goes in. Caution will be out.
Jeff Burton's caught his back straightaway action. Going into turns.
And here's Gordon racing to the line. He's going to get his lap back.
Coming down, here is number 24. Right back up on top of these guys to try to work his way around. 30 other cars back to the lead. Number 99, Burton, is fired up and moving once again. And Sachs, number 20, moving around. He seems to be okay.
You see the net out of the window on the driver's side. That's how they let everybody know they're in good condition. They drop that net so they know not to have to run to him and get there in a big hurry.
Sachs was in sixth and Jeff Burton was in ninth. So it'll be 29 cars that Jeff Gordon has to deal with here. Jeff Burton has refired and he is on pit road with number 99. Exide car right there, just coming onto the pit. You can see the back end a little jammed up. But Greg Sachs day, it looks over.
Now, Jeff Burton came down pit road while it was still closed, so if he can probably make his pit stop, get back out in front of the leaders, but he still is going to have to go to the end of the longest line on the restart because the pit road was closed.
120th lap. Actually, they were working 121 when the incident took place. That has put us under the fifth caution period of the day here in the $4 million Daytona 500. And there's Burton away. Greg Sachs out of Matatuck, New York. His car still resting up against the wall backstretch. Here's what happened.
Okay, everything looks good. And then all of a sudden, Greg comes out of the pack of cars there. Apparently got touched a little bit, buddy, and just sent him down to the inside.
You know, we see this happen so many times. The car is on the outside, does not realize somebody's just behind him and starts to pull over and they make contact and this is the end results.
Well, that's what happened with Ricky Craven in the 125 milers the other day, and he admitted it was his mistake. He tried to slide in and didn't make it.
Well, this is inside Sterling Marlin's car and you can see the car just shoot out there, and that was Jeff Burton's car sliding down to the inside as well. Don't believe Burton hit anything.
Another look.
Boy, those roof flaps did their job there. That 20 car of Greg Sachs tried every way in the world to get off the ground. You see them employ there as they pop up.
Mike?
Four tire changers up and down pit road, and Mark Martin just barely gets out as Jeff Gordon, the last car on the lead lap, gets in. Dick Bergren.
Well, Dale Jarrett took a four-tire stop and had a good stop in the three. Earnhardt had another slow one. He's going to be deep in the field. To Ralph.
Dick, Ricky Craven made a two-tire stop, and it was a brilliant move. He came out second out of the pit area. They went three rounds up on the track bar to loosen the car. Ricky Craven back to the front of this lead pack.
Bad break for Harry Reneer, trying for his fourth 500 win. Won it twice with Cale and once with Buddy Baker. Number 24, under the fifth caution of the day here in the Daytona 500. So while the folks are on pit road, getting the field scrambled a bit, check that out for you. And let's stop for a moment and take a look at something special these days. You ever wonder what all the racing fans do when there's no action on the track at Daytona? Well, there's a new attraction at the raceway, which allows fans of all ages to fulfill their wildest racing dreams. Daytona, USA, the multi-million-dollar interactive motorsports attraction that opened to the public last July. Visitors get an up-close look at America's fastest-growing sport through the 14-minute film, The Daytona Story, and many interactive displays, such as Daytona time trials. Here, if you're fast enough, you go to the top of the running order.
How was that?
Heroes of the Track has eight popular drivers who can't wait to talk to you.
You need to come on over here and talk to me.
Come on over here and ask me some questions. I got some good answers.
Hey, guys, come over here. Get away from them other guys.
Hey, Dale, who's your hero?
I think I'd have to say my dad. He'd be number one on my list as far as heroes.
What about me? I just won the pole.
While Mike Skinner dreams of having his Daytona 500 winning car displayed here at Daytona USA, racing fans get to dream about racing the Daytona pole sitter.
I took Mike Skinner off the pole with Dale Jarrett's Ford. I always dreamed was to drive a Daytona. And can't do it in real life, but you do it on a computer and you beat Mike Skinner or win the pole, it's fantastic.
Yeah, and there it is right over there behind the fourth turn of the Daytona Speedway. Live out your dreams, beat Mike Skinner and Dale Jarrett. Put it right on.
Yeah. Here's Mike Joy.
There is a concern in Bill Elliott's pit. He has fried the clutch on his Thunderbird. Now, it'll only be a problem exiting pit road. He has a transmission in that car that allows him to shift without using the clutch, so only getting out of the pits. Biggest adjustment down here was Sterling Marlin. They made a chassis adjustment, took a round of wedge out of the left rear. Everyone else was tires and fuel. Dick?
Well, last year's winner, Dale Jarrett, is going to get his car back. They put it in Daytona, USA. It sat in the garage today, and they say maybe the car that's on the racetrack today is going to go to Daytona, USA. They do impound the winner for a year. Why? They're very, very happy with Jarrett's car. They haven't touched it in the last two pit stops, and the pit stops have all been fast. Not so with Earnhardt. Talk to the crew chief, talk to the car owner, you get two different answers as to what's going wrong. But for sure, the pit stops are off today with Earnhardt.
As we get set on this restart, Earnhardt will find himself in 13th position. Prior to this race, Mark Martin has led only 15 laps in 12 previous Daytona 500s. Today, he has led 30. There's the pit times adding up. That's from that white line as they come onto pit road to the exit of pit road at the 76 ball. Holding them down as they come to the line. Martin first, Craven second, Dale Jarrett in third. As we're ready to restart this with Martin bringing him across the stripe.
And we see John Andretti down there.
Yep.
He was able to pull up on the inside this time. He's two laps down.
We just made a report on Bill Elliott as far as being able to shift. He's using a Jericho transmission, which is a road racing transmission that you do not need the clutch except to exit pit road. And I'm sure the crew will be ready to push him as he starts out of the pits every time.
Back to speed. Full song as they go into turn three. To Ralph Shaheen.
We're with Greg Sachs. Greg, what took place on the track?
Well, I'll tell you, I was real happy with the Hardy's Thunderbird. My team had done a great job. You know, they brought me from the back up to the front with some good strategies. Coming over turn two there, just kind of got turned around.
You going to get back in it?
I hope so. They say it's not too bad.
Greg Sachs headed back to the car already.
Sure looked bad, torn up front and back after he took that ball. Jeff Gordon, 24th with 24 and on the move.
I'd say on the move. You can see him moving to the outside of the Pennzoil car there. Going down into turn one, Jeff Gordon definitely on the move. That car has been fast all day. Now he's back in the lead lap. Just about lost a lap, but he's up there now fighting his way back towards the lead.
Took 23rd position there. Oh, look at this scramble in the back straightaway. Talk about four wide.
And up there in that scramble is Terry Labonte, last year's champion. He's been having problems today. He got caught up, knocked the toe end out in one of the early wrecks. They worked on that car, and now he's back up there in the top 10.
I
didn't think we'd see him stay back there too long.
Craven stays in second spot, Elegant in third. It would be something if Craven can stay up in this group. Take a look at this traffic, and here comes Gordon down on the inside. He's under Bobby Labonte. That's for 18th position. He's under Kenny Wallace. Trying to take 21st. Ride with him.
What he has to do is be very, very patient right now because he is bottled up in traffic. You can see the outside lane running just a little better than he is. Now he starts in just behind John Andretti there. He has to be patient not to make a mistake.
He's got to find a way to get through the eye of this needle. Keep on attacking. Andretti looking back. There's Gordon coming to the inside. Does he have the room?
Makes it three deep coming out through there. He's going to try to make a spot.
Be a snarl, but he's through and he keeps on the bottom, and he's back up to Bobby Labonte another time for 21st, and Kenny Wallace right there in square D car on the outside. Leader Mark Martin every morning at 5:30. You can find Mark Martin devoted to his bodybuilding work. He stays in such great shape and he needs it right now. Last half of the Daytona 500. It's so close for him. Mark Martin says you only get so much time. It could end out there right now. So I have to keep doing what I'm doing while I can and stay in the best shape that I can. Mark Martin looking back at Ricky Craven.
Boy, Ricky Craven's car looks very, very strong. You can see him moving up on the back of Mark Martin as they head down into turn three. Look at the lines. They're almost identical. Craven went up just a little bit, but he pulled right back down the slipstream. He's drafting right back up on Mark Martin as they head off turn four.
Seven cars in this lead draft beginning to pull away a little bit. Terry Labonte's moved up to eighth place now, but he's about 100 yards or so behind this front group.
The 1995 Winston Cup Rookie of the Year over Robert Presley. That's Craven. Martin looking back at Craven. Craven looking ahead for that first place.
And Ken, that front pack is running. I said a little while ago that they might not be able to match that speed that Dale Earnhardt had run earlier. According to my watch, they're getting awfully close to it here right now. They're turning some fantastic laps.
Jeff Bodine running many laps down, over 40, is back on pit road another time after he was caught in an early incident. Septet up in front. Here's Bill Elliott. What a great day for Georgia. Well, great day for Winston Cup fans who think so much of this Dawsonville, Georgia campaigner and twice winner of the Daytona 500. Elliott is there, a good solid third. He's been running second and third all day long. Is he just waiting, just keeping the paws in the air on that Thunderbird before he turns it loose at the finish? We'll wait and see.
Here's that second group of cars, and boy, they have really been, especially in the tail end of this group, they have really been mixing it up back there in the last three or four laps. And Jeff Gordon has been back there among that group of cars. He was three deep two or three different times we've seen him.
Terry Labonte is in leading that group at eight. Now take a look down to the inside. Here comes Gordon back in the third group, and he's up taking a spot away from Kenny Wallace. And as they've shuffled around, that's for 20th position, 19th position.
How about Dave Marcus still hanging in there with him, running in the lead lap? Having a great day.
As we mentioned at the beginning, Dave Marcus making his 30th performance in the Daytona 500, about to be passed by Gordon. CBS Sports coverage of the Daytona 500 continues after this message and a word from your local station. Back with the leaders, and what a snarl it is here. Yeah, Martin's in front, but look what's changed behind. Craven is on the tail end of this block, and up into the second position has moved Ernie Irvin. Elliott stays right there, a solid third. But how about Ricky Rudd? Ricky Rudd from Chesapeake, Virginia, pulls into fourth. Sterling Marlin finds himself a fifth place running spot. And Terry Labonte is around. Terry Labonte is right up in the midst of this. Dale Jarrett is in there. Craven has fallen to the tail end of this group. And you see Bobby Hamilton, the number 43, We haven't talked about him all day, but he's been solid in that Pontiac, and he's up in what, ninth position now? Picked up another spot. Seventh. Craven fell back dramatically. He was up there battling the lead. Watch what happened.
Yeah, here's how it happened. Bill Elliott pulled up on the outside of him, and the row of Fords went right with him. Ernie Irvin, Dale Jarrett, and everybody just went right along with him and passed him on the outside, and there wasn't anything you could do about it.
Two or three races from now, when they know Craven better, they'll work with him better. But right now, the veterans are all trying to get in place for this assault on the very end part of this race. Craven cannot buy help.
Don't you love it the way Terry Lavani always shows up, no matter how bad things are at the start? At the outcome of these things, he's knocking on the door. Down to Ralph Shaheen.
We're down here with Phil Hammer, who is the crew chief for Ricky Craven. Phil, you can't seem to find any friends out there.
Well, I don't know how many friends there are to have, you know. We got lined up there one time. There was us and six Ford, so I guess that automatically leaves you out, you know. We've come from the back. The Budweiser Chevrolet started dead last today and it's run all the way to the front. And this one's for you, Rick. We miss you down here, buddy. We've been 10 days without having you around. So we'll keep working at it. We got one more stop here to make. We get ourselves a little adjustment and another good pit stop by the Bud Brigade. I think we'll get this thing back to the front.
Trying to get to the front to win the Daytona 500. But, Mike, they have not forgotten about their car owner back in Charlotte.
Four Fords at the front of this field as they come past the stripe and sitting there in third and looking to the high side every time he comes by, trying to poke the nose up is Bill Elliott. Mike Beam is his crew chief. First off, any concern about that transmission while he's out there at speed? And second off, well, you got four Fords in front. What happens next?
Well, I hope we have a caution about lap 170, right around there. You know, so we got to turn our car off to get it going. If we have a green stop, like I say, we're in deep trouble. But Ernie and, you know, Mark and Dale and them, you know, we just have to see. Our car will run, you know. I think Bill's trying to get up front, but, you know, just the people are really jockeying around. So we just have to see how it all falls out.
It will be at 140, 350 miles. He wants a caution around 170 to get them up for an attack on the leaders at the end of this race. But with that transmission problem, there'll be a technical knockout on number 94 today. Hey, a look at the Winston Cup schedule upcoming on CBS. Interstate Batteries 500, that's the new one at that Texas World Speedway, that Texas Motor Speedway, that mile-and-a-half track that Bruton Smith has constructed in Dallas-Fort Worth, and then Michigan, and then the October, the Diehard 500 this year. Grand National. Now we've got the Coca-Cola 300 coming up on April 5th. Again, that's at Texas Motor Speedway on that great new track, then Milwaukee, then St. Louis, and the Grand National Finale down there in Miami, the Jiffy Lube 300. And trucks, I got those too. That's where we got Mike Skinner from. Nazareth, Milwaukee, Louisville, Colorado, and that CarQuest Auto Parts event at Las Vegas is part of a big CBS doubleheader. Grand National and the trucks, the Craftsman Truck Series, right here on CBS to wind up the season.
Well, Ken, you spotted the 10 car there a while ago. I mean, he is running so well right now. Ricky Rudd just has to be just delighted with the way that's just working. He was kind of in the middle part of the pack, and now he's already up to fourth place. I think he may be the guy to beat right now. He is running super well.
Ernie Irvin made a move there coming off of turn four, wanted to get on the inside of Mark Martin, but Mark said, no, that's my spot. Moved right down there and blocked the move. Right now, the lap speeds have slowed down. Mark Martin is running down in the 47.45 to 47.50 second bracket a little while ago. Now he's up to 48.2 tenths seconds around the racetrack, so this group is getting antsy back there.
Five Fords up in front here in the Daytona 500, and leading the way is Mark Martin. Will have his name inscribed on the Harley J. Earl Trophy here at the Daytona International Speedway and be part of Daytona USA. Car will be on display for full year. They'll roll it literally out of Victory Lane through an inspection and right into the museum, and there it will set until next year's Daytona 500. Ah, there's Mark Martin right in front, Ernie Irvin right with him in second, and Bill Elliott, stout race today in third. And you've got Dale Jarrett, last year's winner, following along in fourth. Earnhardt is there in fifth, the number three car. He's back, still attacking, still trying to win this 500 for the first time. Dale Earnhardt, 19 tries, and it still eludes him. Will he win it today? And then Mayfield is in sixth, and Bobby Hamilton. Listen, when he won at Phoenix last year, that was something. But the performance by Hamilton today, running up here into the lead change in front. Here comes Ernie Irvin, scooting down to the inside. He's got Martin, and Ernie Irvin goes out into the lead in the Daytona 500. Back there in seventh. You're looking for Mark Martin up there. That Ernie Irvin, the new leader. Looking back there at Bobby Hamilton in that seventh spot. Yes, he won that first race for Richard Petty as an owner last year. But this show today, he's just hanging on and drafting off anyone he can find. And then just behind him, there you've got the number 10 car. That's Ricky Rudd in eighth position, having a great race. And there's Terry Labonte. There's that number five, ready to attack those leaders as always. Works his way through the field, sorts it out, and on the move.
Sterling Marlin's very close to losing that front draft, and he's falling back just a little bit. But right behind him is Ricky Craven, who also got shuffled out of that group not long ago.
And just behind him comes Skinner. There, well, you see the lap car here of Bodine. He's 30 or 40 laps down after he got caught up in a crash. But the next car up, running in 12th spot, and you can see how much of an interval Mike Skinner has to make up. Get himself go
back up front. Bill Elliott moving up on the high side of Mark Martin coming off of turn two. They got a run on him down the backstretch. Mark Martin might get caught up, as we've seen several do before, down on that inside. And boy, there's not a whole lot you can do about it, but he hangs right in there going into turn three.
Dale Jarrett puts the spurs to the 88, picks up the 94. They try to draft around the outside. Look at this battle from Dale Jarrett's perspective.
You can see right now Mark Martin has absolutely no help on the inside. Here comes Earnhardt on the outside, moving right up on the back of Dale Jarrett's car.
That'll help to push Jarrett on by Martin. Martin's got to go to the back of that pack. There's not a lot he can do about it.
Earnhardt right on his bumper. We have Todd Parrott, the crew chief for Dale Jarrett. Got his line open. See if he has any instructions here. Of course, the spotter is on. Tell him if they're clear so they can get back in line. Hopefully not get nipped by a bumper and turned into the wall at 190 miles per hour.
Martin's still down on that inside. Those front four cars have cleared him. There's Mayfield, car number 37. Boy, blue car up on the outside.
Mark Martin's going to go right to the tail end of this lead line here. He has no choice. He has absolutely no help on the bottom side of the racetrack.
In 1994, a 10% chance of life for Ernie Irvin after that terrible crash in practice on a Saturday morning in Michigan. And 2 years later, right back, duking it out to win the biggest race of them all. From Salinas, California, Ernie Irvin, looking good.
He becomes the seventh different driver to lead this race today.
And Elliott just stays
right there.
Second spot, ready to pounce. Pretty hard to make a choice on anybody here, buddy.
Well, one guy I would like to brag on just a little bit, Jeremy Mayfield, sitting there running the race of his life right now, fifth here in the Daytona 500 in a 37 car. What a great run.
50 laps to go.
We're all around.
Paul Andrews, the new crew chief, has got to be ecstatic about the way this is working today for the Kranefuss Haas team. The intensity of the Daytona 500 into its final moments. And look at this bundle of cars. 29 cars, buddy, in the lead lap.
Oh, 10 of them in the lead draft.
Yep, right there.
Buddy mentioned a moment ago that Sterling Marlin was about to lose the draft, but he has picked it back up and got right back up there with him.
When they got double file in the front and started making those passes for the lead and for second and third, as they start to jumble up again, this is going to bring everybody right back into the fight.
Here comes Earnhardt, the intimidator, and here comes Jeremy Mayfield, number 37, down on the inside and trying to pick up the spot, and Dale Jarrett fights him off.
Jarrett had the momentum off of turn two, pick up Earnhardt. Earnhardt made a good pass going into turn one.
And a very wise move by Mayfield there.
Yes.
Got himself back into position and didn't get dropped off to the bottom of this group.
You know, I have to just sit here and think. Every time I look at that big M on that 94 car, Bill Elliott, knowing when he makes the green flag stop, if he has to, he's probably going to lose everything he's worked for all day.
The 1991 Daytona 500 champion, Ernie Irvin, trying to do it again.
Summary is sponsored by Beechwood Age Budweiser, the king of beers. This bud's for you.
In the 39th Daytona 500, after 153 laps, seven different leaders. Leads change seven times. The average speed is 155, and we've just had another lead change out here. You take a look at the cars out of the event. Dahlenbach, Wallace, Michael Waltrip, Grissom, Hill, and Sachs are gone. And look who's leading. Yes, indeed. The red and yellow colors flying for Wild Bill Elliott out of Dawsonville, Georgia. By five car lengths, he pulls them.
Those cars run side by side back there for second place. That's what Bill Elliott likes to look up in his rearview mirror and see.
And look who comes to second on the outside. Here comes Earnhardt. Ernie Irvin right back on the bottom. I want to show you this pass in a moment, but look at this race.
You have two teammates on the inside of Earnhardt fighting back on the inside. Ernie Irvin's trying to take it as they go into turn one, side by side with Earnhardt, running second.
Dale Jarrett down there. He got shook out a moment ago, but not far back. He pulled himself right back up by the bootstraps. The end of this battle, four-way contest for the lead. Ernie Irvin back for first place. Back straightaway, 3,000 feet, 190 miles an hour. And you can't get a piece of paper between, well, you can at this moment. Going into turn three, back about a car length moves Earnhardt. Elliott looking back out of that McDonald's Ford Thunderbird as he brings it down out of turn number four and to the line to complete the 157th of 200 laps.
Boy, Ernie Irvin needs some help down there. He's caught without a drafting partner on the inside. That outside line should move along, but Ernie Irvin showing a lot of muscle being able to stay up there without any help.
Hey, let's take a quick look at that pass for the lead. This was the move. Elliott high on the track, getting around Ernie Irvin.
That's what we saw Elliott do so well here in the 125-mile qualifying race on Thursday. He just got that high groove working good towards the end of a pit stop run, and that's what they're at now. They're not too far from their last pit stop, and his Ford really works well up there when those tires get hot.
Back with you live, and there is that classic contest. Saw it in 85, saw it in 87. When Elliott won, Earnhardt's there knocking on the door.
He's the eighth different leader, Bill Elliott is.
Boy, Ernie Irvin found a pot of gold. His teammate let him in line there, and he's now in third place. I think if they have a chance, they're going to have to work together because these front two cars are really strong.
Nothing looks better at Daytona for a lot of Winston Racing Cup fans than to see Bill Elliott in command. Hasn't won since Darlington, 1994. That's a winless streak of 63 races. Bill Elliott has said one day you wake up and you think you've forgotten how to drive a race car. Bill, you haven't forgotten a thing.
No, I don't think those inside the sport, they knew that he could still drive a race
Brad,
car.
Listen to the 94.
You're hearing Larry McReynolds doing a bit of coaching. I thought that was Todd Parrott.
That was Todd Parrott.
You're given the word that was Larry McReynolds. That sure sounded like Todd talking to Dale Jarrett back there in the fourth position.
Look who's moving back in the fight here. Right up front is Sterling Marlin. He is in fifth spot right now and really making a charge towards the front.
And he got left on the bottom of the racetrack. I thought he was sayonara, but he's right back in it again. What a run by Sterling Marlin with new crew chief Tim Brewer. The Morgan McClure folks have got to be thrilled about this run today. How about Labonte? How about Rudd? Nemechek all in here. And this race is fast.
They'll have pit stops coming up before long. Just 100 miles to go.
100 miles to the end of the 39th annual Great American Race. Bill Elliott leading. his dad, George Elliott, up there in Dawsonville. In the Dawsonville, Georgia pool hall, I bet they're already ringing the bell and turning on the siren.
For you guys that just joined the telecast, so Bill Elliott does not have a clutch, and if they have to make a green flag stop, he is going to have to kill the motor in the pits and push off out of the pits. It's going to really hurt him.
Yeah, that will really kill him. There's no doubt about it.
Yeah, but what a moment of glory right now to have Earnhardt back behind him, to have Ernie Irvin back there. There you see first and second. There's the interval like nothing. Injured at Talladega a year ago, that car airborne up in turn two of that 2.6-mile track, broke the left femur. He's full of pins and screws and plates, but he's back and looking as great as he ever was. Here's Ernie Irvin fading high. Here comes Dale Jarrett down to the inside. And here for a moment is a word to one of the greatest drivers that ever turned this 2.5-mile track. Ralph Shaheen.
Ken, if you've ever met Bobby Allison, I guarantee you you're a fan of him like I am. Bobby, we miss seeing the Bobby Allison Motorsports team here. What's the story?
Well, you know, we just didn't have things together. You know, Derek left and then Badcock left. And put us in a situation where we weren't in a position to come down here for the Daytona 500.
What do you think of the race we're having here today? How do you think it's going to play out? You've won it yourself.
Well, I'll tell you, a great race going on out there. A lot of good stuff going on. And right now, Elliott's looking awful good, but old Ironhead has looked awful good, and he's hanging in there.
Bobby Allison won it in 1978 for Bud Moore, won it in 82 for Diegard Racing, and one of the greatest races I'll ever be able to tell you about, 1988. With the Stavola brothers with son David right behind him. What a great moment that was. I'll tell anybody, that is as good a show as I'll ever get a chance to see. The Allisons, first and second. That was some.
They passed me to do that.
Yeah, we'll be back with more from Daytona right after this. 165 of 200 laps, and talk about brakes. A caution has just come on the speedway here at Daytona. What a break for Bill Elliott. There is a piece of metal lying just across from the start-finish line. It came off one of the cars, and Elliott, with that transmission problem, has been graced by this caution, number six of the day. Now, there's the piece of metal which they want to have removed before we continue.
One of the lead cars hit that the last time around, Ken. It was laying down sort of the left side of the groove, well, really right in the groove as you go out of the tri-oval here, and one of those front cars, I don't know which one of the 10 in front there hit it, but they'll come in now and make a pit stop, get new tires on, so it won't matter.
Concern for the cars, concern for the spectators, and a big opportunity here for Earnhardt as well as for Elliott to make this pit stop. Could it be Earnhardt's year? In his 18 previous starts, Dale Earnhardt has never won the Daytona 500. Back in 86, Earnhardt was hot on the heels of Jeff Bodine. Three laps to go. Earnhardt ran out of gas, finished 14th. '90, Earnhardt dominated start to finish. Final lap, cuts a tire down, drops from first to fifth. Then in 91.
And there's trouble off the turn two.
Ernie Irvin in front, and Earnhardt.
And Davey Allison. Dale Earnhardt and Davey Allison both out of this race.
Earnhardt coming back on the outside. And in 93. Gets Strickland gets into it. This is the finish.
Did we say five cars had a shot at it? Get ready, because it's coming to the wire. There's Jared Brunt.
In 1995. Sterling Marlin overtook Earnhardt on lap 180, and Marlin never looked back. And last year, dear, it came down to Dale and Dale.
Come on, Dale. Put it in the battle, buddy. Do all you can. Winning two Daytona 500 to be too much. Here he comes to the line, and Dale Jarrett is going to pull it off at Daytona, his second Daytona 500 win.
And in 1997, it could come down to a Dale and Dale show. Here comes 1, 2, and 3 onto pit road. Mike Joy.
Rodney Rhodes raises up Bill Elliott's car. Joe Garone, Gerald Shire changing tires. Brad Hall will put in 1.5 cans of gas. That's all they need. Here's Dick Berggren.
Earnhardt, a quick one. Two tires he took, and just about a can and a quarter, and the crew got the job done when it really counted. To Ralph.
Well, it was an absolutely spectacular stop for Ernie Irvin. They changed four tires, put in both cans of fuel, and got him out in good time, Mike Joyce.
Bill Elliott's car was locked up. They had to push it down pit road, and something locked up. He couldn't get going. Now Ricky Rudd's car fails to fire. They are pushing Rudd down pit road as cars scream by him on the right side. Rudd's car is not running.
And it looked like number four had a problem there. Here's Ricky Rudd giving us these pictures. They're stopping at the end of pit road. It did not go. The frustration for Ricky Rudd, for any driver, to go this far into the race and have this happen. 167 laps complete, 33 to go. Rudd's away. From high above, our overhead coverage from the Goodyear blimp Stars and Stripes, and our thanks to Captain Maloney and the crew for the many spectacular shots in today's telecast of the Daytona 500. We're showing 169 laps complete when they come back to the line this time. Ed, we're down to show and tell time on this one.
Yes, we are. They've made their last pit stops, and we saw some confusion and some problems on pit road there. Everybody knew that this was their absolute most crucial pit stop of the day because track position is so important. Let's watch Ricky Rudd in the Ford number 10. He pulls out and then just stops right there in the middle. You see a crew member almost get run over. Robbie Gordon gets on by him, though. Now the crew has to come down here and push Rudd's car to try to get it refired again, and that really cost him because he's back at the back of the pack.
And there's been a problem for Mark Martin.
Mark Martin had some lug nuts loose and had to go to the back of the field. Terrible break for him. He ran a great race all day. You can see how far back in line he is right now. That's the lead car going through the tri-oval, way up there.
One more lap and they're going to be going. They'll have 30 laps remaining when they get the green. Bill Elliott, not quick on the pit road at all, 48 seconds. But remember, he had that transmission problem.
Yeah, the clutch problem that he had.
31-1 looked pretty good in there.
Well, it'll be interesting to see how the 488 and the three cars make out with just changing right side tires. Remember a year ago, Dale Earnhardt only took, in a similar situation, he only took on two tires, and Dale Jarrett beat him at the end. Some people thought that that was the reason, so who knows?
Ned, don't count out Jeff Gordon either. He is flying, and he's already up to 10th place. He's ninth, as a matter of fact.
West end of the Speedway. Cars organizing for a restart. Coming up next, Big Ten matchup. Indiana and Michigan college hoops following coverage of today's Daytona 500. Mike Joy.
Jim Long is Ricky Rudd's crew chief. Jim, what happened on that stop?
We had a really good stop. We were going to come out pretty good, and we stalled the car a little bit and had to get her going again. So a lot can happen in 30 laps, so we're still optimistic here.
Okay, Ralph Shaheen.
Mike, the 28 car had their best pit stop of the day, better by 1.5, an 18.49, and they did take four tires. So Ernie Irvin could be in really good shape at this point as this race winds down.
He's sitting there in sixth right now.
And as it winds down, the man who won it back-to-back, 94 and 95, Sterling Marlin, who has won four of the past eight events at Daytona and Talladega, is going to be the point man. He can be thankful for that engine built by Sheldon Runt Pittman, who loves working on restrictor plate motors.
He knows how to get the maximum horsepower from them.
Larry McReynolds looking on.
Dale Earnhardt's crew chief this year. Okay, we're ready to go at it.
Buster Rotten has the pace car in the field, rolls under the starter stand, and we're away.
And there's John Andretti down on the inside there. He's trying to make up a lap. Right now, Sterling Marlin would like to clear him and get clear sailing out front right by himself.
Andretti in 30th, two laps down. Marlin first, Jarrett Earnhardt, the top three. Jeremy Mayfield's in fourth, Ward Burton in fifth. And in sixth, it's Ernie Irvin. In seventh, Terry Labonte. Eighth is Bill Elliott. Ninth is Jeff Gordon. Tenth, Jeff Gordon. Benson, number 30, is up to 11th. Musgrave finds himself in 12th as they sort him out on this restart. Nemechek to 13th. Andretti in that RCA car down on the inside. Remember, he's not in the lead lap. You have 29 cars remaining in the lead lap. On the tail end of the lead lap is the 89 champion, Darrell Waltrip. And there is Waltrip running on the tail end of this group up to 28th. Just moved around Hut Strickland in number 8. Number 17, Waltrip, up to 28th position. This is 25th anniversary year. Some say he'll be running a very limited schedule after this season, giving it his best shot in 1997. Look at this shot for the lead. Sterling Marlin in front and Jarrett muscling right there. Chevy against Ford.
And the two guys who have won the last four Daytona 500s, running first and second.
You see Ernie Irvin just behind John Andretti. He's fifth in line right now. He's sitting there on fresh tires, four fresh tires, where other teams took on two tires. It's about 0.2 of a second a lap by yourself out there. Right now they're in traffic, though, and he'd love to get by John Andretti and try to make an assault on the lead.
Earnhardt going to the outside. Brings Irvin with him.
Irvin jumped up there on that outside just as you were saying that, buddy, and he did get around, or well, he's almost around John Andretti.
Well, he's got some powerful help there. Bill Elliott's pushing him as they go down the 3,000 foot back straightaway.
Here comes Irvin to the inside of Earnhardt. Earnhardt's teammate Skinner back in 19th spot, and Earnhardt fading, and here comes Elliott. Wild Bill puts the spurs to the 94.
I believe those guys that took on four tires, I believe that was a smart move.
With more on Bill Elliott, Mike Joy.
Big cheer in this pit, Ken. Mike Beam, you got the break you needed with that caution flag. You lost some time pushing him up, but he is flying to the front.
Yeah, I tell you, you know, prayers are answered there. You know, we're just going to see what happens. But I tell you, this McDonald's car is pretty strong. All these guys worked hard this winter.
What did they find in that engine shop late Thursday night?
I can't tell you.
And even if he could, he wouldn't, Ken.
Look on the outside here. This is the run for second place right now. Ernie Irvin's going by his teammate, Dale Jarrett, down on the bottom, and then Bill Elliott's hooked right to the back of him as they go by.
Dale Jarrett's going to wind up in about 10th place after this is all over, because that outside lane is just going to go right on by him.
And they're not going to give him any room to pull in.
So the teammate situation went right out the window there.
Here comes Gordon. Jeff Gordon is back in it. Fighting for six. And you're riding with Jeff Gordon. Marlin out in front, Irvin in second, Elliott. What a race. This 39th Daytona 500 as Jeff Gordon just gets himself up against the wall. Here comes Terry Labonte as well.
Jarrett was able to slip up in front of Terry Labonte.
Found a hole. Dale Jarrett slides back into this single line traffic. Here comes Gordon peeking on the inside. Mistake, we'll see.
I believe it will be. That train will go by on the outside, but maybe he has enough car that he can do it.
Hung out to dry. Gordon to the 24. And we'll be back as we move toward a conclusion in the 39th Daytona 500. 175 complete.
The official beer of NASCAR. Goodyear, number one in tires. And by Havoline Formula 3 Motor Oil. Add more life to your car.
21 laps to go, and they come by this time, 52 and a half miles, and look who's back in front. Bill Elliott is there. And Earnhardt, in his 19th try to win the 500, has moved into second position, and Jeff Gordon has come to third. Ernie Irvin relegated to fourth. Just behind him, it's Dale Jarrett, the defending champion, and then Terry Labonte waiting as the ice man always does. Bill Elliott is just having a glorious day. Transmissions busted, had to be pushed off. Bill Elliott has said, hey, when we got started in Winston Cup Racing, we had no idea what we were getting into. We were just a bunch of boys from the mountains in Georgia, trying to make a race. And we used to pray, please God, just let us get in the field. Get in the field he has. Look at him running now, trying for his 41st victory and his third Daytona 500 title.
Well, that would be a popular win.
And Earnhardt, the frustration all those years, no matter how he tries to downplay it, to not win this race. Boy. For more on the Earnhardt story, here's Dick Berger.
Larry McReynolds, you have the look of a worried man. What's the story here? Two tires, a lot of the guys around you took four. You're going to be able to get it done with just those two?
I don't really question the tire deal, Dick. You know, it's one of those deals if, you know, if we get the right help and we're at the right place at the right times. Like I just told Richard, I said, what do you think? You know him better than I do. He said, I've been here a lot of times before, and you can bet he's been in the floor pan right now with that throttle pedal, but if it's a race in God's time to shine on that three, we'll just have to see.
The crew did its job the last time around. To Ralph Shaheen.
Dick, Mark Reno is the new crew chief for Ernie Irvin. You made a great call to take four tires on that last stop. What will you do drafting strategy-wise now as we get down inside of 20?
Well, I don't think we have a lot of strategy now. It's all up to Ernie, and, you know, we took a call and did four tires. This Texaco crew, they're bad to the bone, and Ernie's doing a good job, and, well, we're just going to let him hang it out now.
Will there be anything set up with the 88 car?
Well, we'd sure like to hope they'd help each other, at least to the last lap.
Mike Joy?
Bill Elliott's Thunderbird likes its nose in the wind. Elliott has been able to pass at will, and that car seems to be better out front. There is no chatter on the radio in the Elliott camp.
Well, the advantage of having four tires is for about 10 laps, and then as they get hot, they become used tires just like everybody else is on, and the draft right now has kept these cars that just took on two tires close, and now I would say it's pretty even right now for all the cars as far as working around the racetrack.
Six cars have sort of broken away from the seventh place car of Jeremy Mayfield. Gonna try to settle it among themselves up there.
Bill Elliott in the cockpit of number 94. Sam Moses once wrote, Elliott on the track is smooth, smart, efficient, restrained, sometimes not even noticed until the finish when he drives into victory lane. Will he drive into victory lane today? Earnhardt says not. Gordon says not. But you can be sure the folks up in Georgia are saying, go for it, Bill.
I think he figures he's in the right place, and I think he is. It's very difficult to pass, but, you know, just one little slip and they'll be by. But the leader has had the advantage most of the time here during this speed week. Remember last year, Dale Jarrett went out in front of 23 laps to go and managed to hang on.
Three Fords, three Chevys in that lead draft.
You're riding with Jeff Gordon down the back straightaway just then. Jeff Gordon's got a lot of car. Look at Dale Jarrett coming on the inside, going into turn three, passing his partner there, Ernie Irvin.
Has Jarrett got enough? Can he bring it to the front? Twice he's done it. The upset in 93. The great win over Earnhardt in 96. Earnhardt. Line in second spot. Is this all there is? Or can he pounce? Can he attack? Can he defeat the four that continue around this track in first?
Or will those two Chevrolets team up there? Dale Earnhardt and Jeff Gordon.
Taking a look back at that second group for a moment. Fight is still on there. You see Nemechek in there and Bobby Labonte. They continue their war.
Great battle going on back there.
Sterling Marlin back in that ninth position.
Remember, Sterling was leading a little while ago. Got shuffled back and all the way back into that second group. 15 laps to go.
Just a little while ago, Ken was talking about Terry Labonte. Look at the tail end of this line right here. He's still in contention. The right thing happens, the right draft, right partner. He could put himself right up front.
Back to Dick Berggren on pit road.
With Todd Parrott, you did a good job. Your driver did a good job out there getting past Ernie Irvin, but there's still a few more up front. How will you get by them?
got Dale Jarrett driving the race car and got one of them Robert Yates engines in there. So just hopefully those two packages work together and he take that thing to the front for our second in a row.
Well, there's confidence in a good PR man, too, to Mike Joy.
Ray Evernham, can you make a deal with the devil? Can Jeff and Dale Earnhardt work together and get past that Ford?
I don't think you can make a deal with anybody in that front pack right now. Anybody in that first six cars, if it stays like this right now, they all can go for the win. So I don't think anybody's going to make a deal. You know, you might make a deal when you start the pass, but they're certainly not going to make the deal to stick with it when they finish it.
Ken, remember what happened Thursday in the qualifying race when Gordon ran right up behind Earnhardt. Earnhardt complained it made him very, very loose.
Mike, we need to say hi to Rick and Linda and everybody sitting home. We're thinking about you, boss.
What you talking about? Rick Hendrick, car owner for Jeff Gordon, and the number five of Terry Labonte, number 25 of Ricky Craven. Rick fighting cancer right now, and our prayers and best wishes with him.
Life-threatening leukemia. And Jeff Gordon asked him what we can do, and he said, just go out, try to win that race, try to win the championship. Gordon said, boss, deal.
You see Earnhardt looking about a half a car length under Bill Elliott. Bill Elliott running a very, very smooth line through the corners. He's going to be tough to pass on either side.
Talk about race cars, talk about horsepower, talk about tires all day. Right here, right now, it's hard.
And they're running speeds right now close to their qualifying efforts. It's time, though. If you got anything left, you've got to put it up front right now.
I've never seen Bill Elliott more relaxed, more at ease in this time. I think of those, like 1989 when he broke his wrist. Remember they were trying the radial tires the first time, he slapped the wall, 195 miles an hour. Those wins in 85 and 87, all those frustrating years for Earnhardt. So close, so many times when it should have been his, and it wasn't. And for Jeff Gordon, he's doing this for someone else.
Here goes the pass. Gordon making a move on the inside of Earnhardt. Oh, Jarrett's loose.
Down the back straightaway. Big trouble. Earnhardt out. Up and over number three. And for the 19th time, Lady Luck deals a bad hand to Earnhardt. And here's number 88, Jarrett, back underway. Caution is out. This is in lap 188 as they come to the line. Elliott brings them across. And there's damage on the side of number 24, Gordon. Rest of the field coming up. They were on the binders trying to get out of that dilemma up in front. Craven comes across. There's Ernie Irvin's car. It's in trouble. A dramatic turnaround, and look at the abuse as the Earnhardt car flipped over the 28. He went over the top. All the intensity and all the drama of 1979 are being relived in this Daytona 500. Dale Earnhardt, who was so savaged in that race at Talladega, and he got out and waved to the crowd, broken ribs, broken sternum, broken collarbone, and he gave the crowd the thumbs up.
Here
he comes. He's climbing out again. Truly a remarkable American hero, stymied another time at Daytona. Walked away from another one on the super speedways. Earnhardt, let's look at what happened. Back straightaway.
Well, you can see him coming off. That's Jeff Gordon right under Earnhardt. Earnhardt gets into the outside wall, moves over in traffic there. Everybody checked up. There's contact from the car just behind him.
Dale Jarrett
got into him just a little bit. You can see Ernie Irvin there slamming into the outside wall.
And going under him. The end of another 500 for Dale Earnhardt. From inside Jarrett's car, watch these pictures.
Well, he was going to follow. He saw Gordon make the move coming off of turn two, and those cars get close together up there, and Earnhardt gets into the wall.
You could see Earnhardt's car get sideways just before he got to the wall there. He could not control it. It got over into the wall, and it was a chain reaction from there on. Watch him come through here. Watch it turn sideways just a little bit. Bam, right into the wall there. Now everybody didn't have time to check up.
I think Ernie got into the back, and Terry got into the back of Ernie Irvin. He got the 28 car into the back of the 88. The five in there was a chain reaction, as you said, just backed him up. And the result, dire straits for Dale Earnhardt. The hood from the number 28 up over the fence and possibly into the Tiny Lund grandstand, we understand. At regular speed. Hard game, the stock car racing. Can't believe how hard it is on Dale Earnhardt. So close so many times, right up there with the contender. And here we are, 10 laps from the finish, and it's over for him again.
I feel very safe in the
car. Still under caution now. Cars off the track, a total of six, and there you see them. That is the race summary. And this is the story of the Daytona 500. You're in the pits. Car number three, Earnhardt, and Dick Berggren is there.
What a pile of grit. Earnhardt is in the car. He's barking instructions to the crew. They're trying to tape the left rear fender on. It's barely hanging on. They're taping the hood on. The roll cage has been sandpaper. NASCAR apparently has declared he must have a spoiler, so they're going to now try to get the back deck on the car. There's nothing mechanical holding it on. They're going to have to tape it on. This thing is so beat up. If Earnhardt can make one lap or two, it's an absolute miracle. He's obviously okay behind the wheel. Let's go back up to Ken Squire.
He's rolled the car. It's gone all the way over, and there has been an injury in the Lund grandstand. The hood off number 28 flew up over the fence and is gone into the grandstand. And they are now taking a spectator out of that area. We'll update you on that story as we get more information. Watch again what happened out of turn two in front of the Lund grandstand.
Jeff Gordon tried to pass Dale Earnhardt on the inside. The air just pushed Earnhardt over into the outside wall. Dale Jarrett couldn't get slowed down quick enough, bumped Earnhardt, then Ernie Irvin. It was a chain reaction type deal, goes right under Earnhardt. I thought they were back there ready to load that car on the wrecker. I thought that's what was waiting on, and first thing I knew, Dale Earnhardt was driving it down pit road.
That's incredible, but you know what happened there, Ned? This close to the end of the race, when you get into trouble, Earnhardt was not going to lift right there. The car's out of shape. He hits the outside wall, then into Gordon, and you see behind, everybody just started checking up, and it was just chain reaction from there.
And the hood comes off. You can see the hood flying up into the Tiny Lund grandstand at that moment as Ernie Irvin came through. A victim of circumstance, nothing he could do. He was right in the middle of it.
And Terry Labonte was running at the tail end of that, went through all of that unscathed, not one scratch on the number five car, Terry Labonte.
I do think that that front on that car may have just nosed into that 28. There was a little bit of chain reaction, but he did check up in time as they came through that. Here's Mike with more.
Ken, Jeff Gordon told his crew it was all I could do to get out of his way. There was apparently no contact between those two cars.
Okay, we're racing again.
Coming down for green, six laps to go as they come to the line, six to go. Elliott in front. Now, what about that transmission?
Bill Elliott's running that car with just a shifting lever. It's a Jericho transmission that we use on the road course, and it's not required to have a clutch.
Hendrick Cars, second, third, and is that fourth for Craven? Look at him trying to break that draft in the back straightaway. Could happen again. Elliott in front. Five to go when they come by. Can he stay there? Jeff Gordon has come into second spot. Terry Labonte with him. And now you have those Hendrick's cars, second, third, and fourth. Will they team up and try to take it away from the Ford?
Still 28 cars on the lead lap, and all of them right in this lead
and
draft.
and the graphic was incorrect. We are now being told there are six laps to go. Graphic was incorrect, and there are six remaining now.
Whoa, down on the flat here. Gordon's trying to get by Elliott, going into turn one.
And Elliott gives him room.
But look at...
And look at Labonte going up the outside, and here comes Craven. The Hendricks stable giving it their best for Rick Hendricks here today. In the back straightaway, Gordon out in front. Ricky Craven drops down in front of Bill Elliott. Meanwhile, up on the outside, Sterling Marlin begins to roll.
This is going to be one wild scramble right down to the end for a lot of positions back through there.
Jeremy Mayfield bringing the number 37 up another spot. It could be 1, 2, 3 for Hendrick. Craven is into third from 40th starting position. Newberg, Mains, Ricky Craven, the new guy on the team, replacing Ken Schrader, goes up into third. Can he stay there? Elliott is ready to attack and try to take it back.
The three Hendricks cars have nailed themselves to the bottom of the racetrack, and right now it's 1, 2, 3 Hendricks cars.
Sterling Marlin in fourth. Bill Elliott back to fifth. Mayfield is in sixth. Ward Burton seventh. Martin is eighth. And Hamilton the petty car is in ninth.
Here comes Bill Elliott back on the inside off turn four.
And trouble. There's trouble coming down off that banking. 1, 2, 3. Benson's car among them as they come to the line. Caution is coming out. That could be the final lap under green. And if it is, Gordon has won with Terry Labonte second and Craven third. Dale Jarrett caught up. And there you see Kenny Wallace in that incident. Brent Bodine's number 11 is involved. And there's the number one of Morgan Shepherd all torn up. Now we're showing 196 complete. And there are cars scrambled all over the fourth turn area of this 2.5 mile track. Pace car has picked up the front of the field. Hendrick cars were 1 and 2 here in 89 in the Daytona 500. There's Morgan Shepherd pulling off the helmet, buddy.
I was just looking at 30 car Johnny Benson. He has a lot of damage to the nose of the yellow car down there.
Crews going out quickly. They all look at the 73. That's that Barkdahl starting position that went to Joe Nemechek.
Boy, you had to know something was going to happen there. There were so many cars that were bunched up together. They're just jockeying for position. Oh,
that Pontiac, that's a hard hit. His sister Barb down here runs his fan club, about 4,000 folks, big supporters of Johnny Benson from not only Michigan but Wisconsin, the Midwest. Former Grand National Rookie of the Year and Winston Cup Rookie of the Year. Johnny Benson, the Bahari car. Oh, look at this. There's the 90. Dick Trickle's car. They're trying to get Dick out of the number 90 car. There's Morgan Shepherd getting into the ambulance.
He's okay, thank goodness.
Nemechek away. Gave it such a great ride. Was up in the top 10 for a while. Over to talk to some of the safety crew. To come so far, to get so close, and have it end this way.
That was Johnny Benson getting out of the car there, walking with the attendants there. He looks to be in good shape.
Take a look at what happened here in the final moments of this Daytona 500. Benson on the outside in the yellow car.
Bobby Hamilton gets into him right there, right in the center, spins him around, hits Skinner. There comes the...
Joe Nemechek had absolutely nowhere to go. That's him right against the wall sliding down through there.
Dale Jarrett down on the inside with Kenny Wallace spinning around. Jarrett had got by it as far as being hit and then gets hit again right there by Wallace. You know, just a victim of circumstances, all of it.
Ride for the second wild ride of the day with Dale Jarrett.
So he gets down off of the flat part of the, on the flat part of the track, then Wallace comes down and gets into him, or was knocked down into him, I should say. He didn't just drive it down there into him. Then goes up and hits the outside wall, and then Kenny's going to come back down once again and hits Jerry.
197 now complete. Lake Speed was caught up at that in the number 9. Jarrett finally gets it. Woad, another view.
You see Bobby Hamilton there. He just touches Benson right there on the left rear corner, and that sets a chain reaction off. You can see up on the top there, Joe Nemechek in the 73. Morgan Shepherd in the one, now turned sideways and all around them. Lake Speed's in that.
And for the second time today, Mike Skinner got out of something that you would thought he would have had no car at all. Earlier, he just missed by a fraction, and again. Kenny Wallace hit him once and got him again. Nothing Kenny could do. Dramatic stuff. Telestrator. Show you what happened here.
Right here. These three cars and Bobby Hamilton right in the middle. And you're going to see when we start to move it that his car is going to move up the racetrack right up into the 30 car of Johnny Benson. They make contact, shoots Benson down across the track, almost gets Mike Skinner. Then up there in front of Joe Nemechek up on the outside. Morgan Shepherd up there as well. Kenny Wallace loses control. Here's Lake Speed back there. Bobby Labonte down on the inside. Dick Trickle gets hit hard. Lots of good race cars torn up here.
Over half of the field has been involved in wrecks here today in this 500. Picking up Dick Trickle's number 90. They want to get this race back for one lap. What a shootout that'll be. Gordon, Labonte, Craven, 1-2-3, Elliott, 4th, Marlin, 5th, Mayfield, 6th, Martin, 7th, Ward Burton, 8th, Ricky Rudd is in 9th, and do you believe it? Darrell Waltrip is up into 10th spot. They're trying to get.
Good to see.
55 years old.
Yeah. Wow, they've given them the signal to get the green flag the next time around.
That can't be. They'll have to move Trickle's car before they can have a green start.
They're going to have to move it in a hurry.
He's walking over. Dick Trickle.
They're going to get the car out of the way.
We may get a final lap.
Yep. Dale Jarrett has pulled into the pits to get tires because apparently he had, we know the tires would have been flat spotted. He was sitting there in 20th place, and there's still about 23 or 24 cars on the lead lap.
Let's listen as Dale Jarrett came down pit road.
To have a pit stop if they were going to have their left front tire is shredded, and if they were going to get the green flag again, he was hoping that they might be able to go the rest of the way under caution. He could have probably ridden it out.
Well, Darrell Waltrip in that 25th may end under yellow. I think that's what we're coming to here. We're going to end this race under yellow. In one of the most remarkable 500s in history, there is oil on the track. And they do not run a green, white, and checker as they do in the truck races. And Rick Hendrick Stables is going to finish first, second, and third. Gordon, Labonte, and Craven, if they can keep running here just under this caution. Here's Mike Joy.
Ray Evernham has been coaching his driver, telling him it's not over yet, it's not over yet, and it's not. But Ray, you're about to win the Daytona 500.
Well, if he gets around here one more time, and I don't know. I'm just thank God, because he's the one that lets all this happen. But I want to thank Rick Hendrick and Linda. I know you're home there, and if these guys can make it around one more time, boss, you got your first wish. 1-2-3 in a Daytona 500. And I don't know, Mike. I mean, it's just I don't know. It's a long way from Wall Stadium.
That's where he started, on a little short track in New Jersey, just like every driver in this field started at some tiny track somewhere to try to get here.
Brooke Gordon has been asked to leave the compound area where they keep the units for these drivers. Crew is taking her down toward Victory Lane. You're going with her right now for Hendrick Racing. What a moment. His first 500 at age 25. We saw him win a 125 miler here when he was 21. Saw him win the Busch Clash at 22. And there he is at the controls, at the keyboard of Rick Hendrick's number 24. Number one car is still putting out oil around the track. We're getting that report. That's why we couldn't get this back going. Let's go to Ralph.
Brooke, you're not running down this pit lane. You're floating down here. How thrilled are you right now?
I'm just so thrilled to death, but has the checkered flag
flown yet. That's all I need to know.
I'll tell you what, if you stop right here and watch that start finish line right there, you're going to see it fall in just about half a lap.
I'm just so happy for the whole team, and especially this is for Rick Hendrick and Linda Hendrick. We talked to him last night, and last thing Jeff said to him, he said, I hope to tell you congratulations for winning the Daytona 500, and I know this is going to mean so much to him.
Well, some tells me there's probably going to be a cell phone waiting for you when you get to victory lane to call Rick and tell. So.
Thank you.
Jeff Gordon, young, loves the NBA, all pro sports, video games, outspoken, aggressive. Terry Labonte, the quiet guy who likes to hunt and fish, would rather slide in the back door and not be seen. There they are, first and second in the Daytona 500.
Kenny is almost a lap down, fought his way back into contention, and now to win the biggest race of all Winston Cup races, the Daytona 500.
Jennifer Fry in the Washington Post wrote about the different style of these two people. The quiet one, Terry Labonte, the reserved conservative, and Jeff Gordon, the young and flashy one. Jennifer couldn't have hit it better, and they couldn't have hit it better. Look at them lining up to come across. Checkers and yellow. And Terry Labonte pulls up, and here comes the 25 car up. This reminds me of the 24 hours of Daytona, the year the Ferraris won it. First, second, and third, and they lined up across the line. We've never seen it. One year we did. I believe the Porsches did it, but never in a stock car race. This is a first. The top three, all from the same racing stable, Chevrolets, dominate the 39th annual Great American Race in honor of their car owner, Rick Hendrick. We'll go to victory lane in a moment. At Daytona, Jeff Gordon has just become the youngest man ever to win the Daytona 500 at 25 years of age. What a finish for Hendrick Motorsports. Gordon first, Labonte second, Craven third. From 40th position, Ricky Craven drives to third. Riding with Jeff Gordon here as he heads for victory lane. Let's go quickly to Ralph Shaheen.
Well, we're down here with Bill Elliott. Bill, quite a finish, but you had problems with the clutch. Did that cost you at the end?
Well, it kind of hurt. It really didn't cost us. You know, whenever Jeff and Terry and Ricky hooked up, I was history. I mean, I knew it. I was a sitting duck at the end, but I got to hand it to these McDonald's guys. They did a heck of a job. You know, Amoco Races, New Holland, Coca-Cola, all just pitched in there and really made my year come together. Super 8's on the car this day, and I'm telling you what, I'm just tickled to get through it, and we'll go to Rockingham next week.
And it could be a good year for Bill Elliott. It looks like he's back on track. Mike Joy in victory lane.
He has been here for the Pepsi 400, the Busch Clash, the Twin 125, everything you could win in a Winston Cup car, and now he's on the cell phone to Rick Hendrick, on the phone to Charlotte, North Carolina.
Hey, Rick.
Can I tell Rick?
And if I can get there, we'll listen in.
Did I tell you what we're going to do it or what? I told you, man. Hey, I got to go talk to the world here, buddy. Thank you so much. We love you, and this one's for you, man. All right, thanks.
Woo! Jeff Gordon, come on out here.
Yes.
Winner of the Daytona 500, youngest driver to do it. How many Winston Cup drivers carry a cell phone in their car?
Well, they handed it to me right as I came to Victor Lane. And that's the first person I want to talk to anyway. No offense, Mike, but
okay.
This one's for Rick Hendrick. One, two, three. That is so awesome. Thank you, God. Oh, my goodness.
When you were deep in that field and you were trying to get everybody to line up because you could pull them to the front,
Rick,
if you could get
you,
back
Mike.
There. How tough, how frustrating was that to be mired back there?
Well, you know, it was real frustrating. I mean, I was sitting back there, you know, and I couldn't get anybody to work with me there for a little while. You know, it's just really, really tough to get up through there. And I was just real patient. And I just prayed to God that, you know, hey, you know, if I'm going to glorify you on this day, you got to give me a caution. And the caution came out. So this one certainly is for God.
We'll be back to victory lane in a bit. Now let's go to Dick Berggren.
With Terry Labonte, who finished second today. Front end of the cars all pushed in. You made some extra pit stops, early jingle. Did you think ever that this could possibly be a 1-2-3 thing?
No, I really did. And I'll tell you what, it was just a great day for Hendrick Motorsports. I want to say hi to Rick Hendrick back home. And I'll tell you what, it was awesome. I couldn't be happier for all of us coming down here and finishing first, second, and third. It was just a great day. And I'm proud of these guys in the Kellogg Chevy. They worked hard. We spent half the day in the pit straightening out the body. I think it's tore it worse than my Martinsville car, but it was a good run for us.
And Ricky Craven here finishing fine third position today. What's it mean to you to have this Hendrick team come in 1-2-3 in your first ride with them?
Well, I needed to redeem myself, you know, from the week. And I got to tell you, there's not a person in the world with greater regard for people than Rick Hendrick. He was very gracious to me, and today all three of us paid him back. And it's for you, Rick. I just can't wait. This season's going to give us our first win, and need to be patient. I got a great team. This Bud team is awesome. And they did things for me today that I had never been exposed to. They kept me settled down. You know, I had several opportunities to blow it, but we're going to get our win.
After Thursday with that demolished front end, could you imagine yourself here today?
Well, I never gave up. Part of my problem Thursday was that I was so excited to be in this Bud car, and I just overdid it a little bit. But Rick talked to me. He settled me down, and we're going to be good all year.
Back to Ken.
For Rick Hendrick and for Travis Roy. 20th career win for Jeff Gordon, the Daytona 500. 61st career win for Rick Hendrick as a car owner.
Is sponsored by Ford and your Ford dealer. Have you driven a Ford lately? McDonald's. Our speed and accuracy have made us the official drive-through of NASCAR. And by Napa Auto Parts. We keep America running.
It's always a matter of winners and losers, and the hard loss today was suffered by the driver standing by with Ralph Shaheen.
Well, here he is, a seven-time champ. Dale, I can't believe we're having this conversation again. You got out of the car after flipping, and you got back in. What went through your mind through all of that?
Well, I just wanted to get back in the race and try to, you know, make laps, and we're running for a championship. Our hopes for the Daytona 500 were over there. Gordon came up under me, and the car pushed off the corner, and I got into the wall, got back in him, checked up a little bit. Somebody hit me from behind. Next thing I know, we're on the roof again. Luckily, no one else hit the car. We just sort of bounced around up on our lid a little bit and scuffed around, tore the back end up, whatever. I got an ambulance, and I looked back at the car, and I said, man, the wheels are still on that thing. I got out of the ambulance and asked the guy inside the car. They was hooking it up. I said, see if it'll crank, and he cranked it up. I said, get out. Give me the car back. So I drove it back around here, and we taped it up, and it's just, it's frustrating for me, for the guys that work so hard. Everybody works so hard on the team, and getting these race cars down here, we run good and qualified good, won the qualifying race. You know, I don't know that we could have won the Daytona 500, but we were sitting there ready for a shot, and I think Gordon was a little impatient at that point, but still, you know, he went on and won the race. He's running his race, but that's the way it goes. I mean, you know, I pushed off the corner and got in the wall a little, and you know, I could have took him out too, but I was trying to stay off him, and got back, and somebody turned me from the back, and then it was all over with.
Thank you, Dale. He's 31st today. To Mike Joy in victory lane.
In 1957, Bill France Sr. made the first presentation of the Harley J. Earl Trophy to Cotton Owens on the Daytona Beach Course. The trophy commemorates Harley Earl, longtime GM stylist, and today we revive that proud tradition. Here's the president of Daytona International Speedway, John Graham.
Jeff, congratulations on your first Daytona 500 win, your first of many, I'm sure, and we'll look forward to inscribing your name on the Harley J. Earl Trophy, symbolic of the champion of the Daytona 500, and this will be on display for fans to see 364 days a year in Daytona, USA. Congratulations.
Oh, wow, what an honor. Woo. I asked them if I could have a replica of this. Maybe they can make a smaller one, but thank you so much. I tell you, this is the greatest honor that I could ever have. This is definitely the greatest motor speedway in all the world, and I couldn't be happier right now than for you to give me this trophy. Trust me, this is a great honor.
You've won the Winston Cup. You've been on the stage in New York to receive that $1 million, but is this the biggest day of your life?
You know, right now, because I feel like I appreciate this race more than anything right now, I think that it truly is. I tell you, I can't tell you the way I feel right now inside. It's so hard to win this race, and I'm very, very excited.
Ken Squire.
Woo!
take a look at the final standings here today. What a day for Rick Hendrick. A year ago, had the Winston Cup Championship top of the world. The world turned upside down for him, indicted in the Honda scandal, diagnosed with a life-threatening cancer, and then he finishes first, second, and third in this Daytona 500, watching it from home as he prepares for chemotherapy. Taking a look at 7 through 12, Skinner, teammate to Earnhardt, winds up back there in that 12th position. Good run for him. And Darrell Waltrip in 10th place.
How about that, guys? Kyle Petty finishing up there. Musgrave, Hamilton, Robbie Gordon. Dave Marcus in 17th place. Great run for him. Brett Bodine, 18th.
A couple of stories we need to update you on. Robert Presley, the driver of number 29, has been released from the hospital. There was one fan. As you saw him, he was conscious, taken to the infield care center. He is still there. We do not have another update on that. So that's it for today. There's your winner, Jeff Gordon, after 8 cautions, 29 laps under yellow. He's the winner of the 39th annual Great American Race. For Ned Jarrett, Buddy Baker, Mike Joy, Dick Bergeron, and Ralph Shaheen, Ken Squire saying so long from Daytona International Speedway, where Jeff Gordon has won the 1997 Daytona 500.